Unsere liberale Demokratie. Das ist Freiheit, Pluralität, Rechtsstaatlichkeit. Wie tragen wir unsere Demokratie in die Zukunft? Und wie verteidigen wir sie gegen Anfeindungen von innen und außen? Diese Frage stand seit 2017 im Mittelpunkt der Veranstaltungsreihe Forum Bellevue zur Zukunft der Demokratie. Die Gäste? Deutsche und internationale Persönlichkeiten aus Wissenschaft, Politik, Medien und Kultur.
Ich erlebe jeden Tag, dass wir eine Demokratie haben und hoffentlich erhalten wir sie.
Also ich meine, dass es Mächtige gibt, die auf diese Art den Schriftsteller loswerden wollen, das hat ja nun wirklich niemand so drastisch und welthistorisch erlebt in der letzten Zeit wie Salman. In der liberalen Demokratie, in der wir leben, fordert der Schriftsteller dann eben auch den Schutz des Staates.
Ich glaube, was wir uns alle sehr klar machen müssen, ist, dass natürlich diese Vertrauensfrage in der Demokratie keine Einbahnstraße ist.
40 verschiedene Standpunkte, Blickwinkel und Thesen zur Zukunft unserer Demokratie.
We also must not forget that democracy is still the best form of government as far as human well-being is concerned. People in democracies are richer, healthier, happier and better educated and have more rights.
Ich bin nicht nur Anhänger der Demokratie, weil das das Amt eines Verfassungsrechtlers ist, die Demokratie als normative Ordnung zu verteidigen, sondern ich bin zutiefst überzeugt davon, dass das die eigentliche zivilisatorische Antwort auf das Wachsen der Vernunft der Menschheit ist, die Demokratie. Und dass sie deshalb alternativlos ist.
Aber das Wichtigste ist, glaube ich, die Verteidigung der politischen Kultur des Westens innerhalb Deutschlands selbst.
Welche Lehren ziehen wir aus der Pandemie?
Natürlich ist es so, dass wir auch als Gesellschaft den Reichtum der wissenschaftlichen Politikberatung, den wir haben, vielleicht doch noch etwas professionalisieren, institutionalisieren, um besser gerüstet zu sein, wirklich vorbereitet auch in einer exponentiellen Wachstumssituation beispielsweise dann nachvollziehbar zu reagieren.
Wie kann der digitale Strukturwandel so gestaltet werden, dass er die Demokratie stärkt?
This is now that democracy got to catch up with technology. So exactly this question about how to make sure that when you become a powerful giant, that you also realize the responsibility that you have. And you can only do that, I think that is absolutely clear, with regulation.
But in Europe, we have many years of work already done and who have developed what are, in my view, in the Digital Services Act and the Digital Markets Act, two of the most promising comprehensive proposals for new rules and standards anywhere in the world. This is why I believe that we have a great deal of hope in Europe.
Wie gelingt uns in der Demokratie die Transformation, die angesichts des Klimawandels unumgänglich ist?
Das Erdsystem verändert sich in einer Form, wie es das in 10.000 Jahren eben nicht getan hat. Und das ist ja die Gerechtigkeitsfrage. Also je länger wir uns Zeit lassen, umso stärker wird die soziale Frage dann von zukünftigen Generationen oder eben aus anderen Teilen der Welt getragen werden.
Welche Funktionen haben Kultur und Medien in der Demokratie?
Man nimmt natürlich in den Filterblasen immer wahr, was bei den anderen passiert, aber man glaubt natürlich nichts davon. Alles wird immer nur noch belegt dazu, für das, was man ohnehin schon glaubt. Und man ist oft gar nicht mehr in der Lage, das anders zu sehen. Man will es nicht nur, man kann es auch einfach nicht anders.
Also was auf jeden Fall der Fall ist, dass im Mittel, als Wissenschaftlerin gesprochen, muss man immer wichtig, nicht zu pauschalisieren, im Mittel wir auf jeden Fall zu viele negative Nachrichten bekommen. Wenn das dann dazu führt, dass ich mich von den anderen, den eigentlich weltbewegenden Dingen, gesellschafts-, demokratiebewegenden Dingen, Zukunftsfragen, die über meinen eigenen kleinen Wirkkreis hinausgehen, nicht mehr beschäftige, weil ich das Gefühl habe, ich kann eh nichts dagegen machen und es belastet mich, dann ist das natürlich problematisch für die Demokratie.
Wie passen Religion und Demokratie zusammen?
Ich bin sehr optimistisch, dass dadurch, dass diese jungen Menschen immer mehr Räume an Schulen, an Universitäten bekommen, ihre Religion zu reflektieren, dass sie dafür sorgen werden, dass ein europäisch geprägter Islam sich immer stärker etablieren wird.
Welche neuen Ideen gibt es? Gegen das Unbehagen an der Demokratie ist die Einbeziehung der Bürgerinnen und Bürger ein wirksames Mittel. Und zwar in Bezug auf die Wiederherstellung der demokratischen Legitimität und deren Wirkungskraft.
Es ist auch sehr wichtig, dass die Zukunftskonferenz, in der sich Bürgerinnen und Bürger europaweit mit neuen Ideen für eine stärkere Europäische Union befasst haben, dass diese Ergebnisse ernst genommen werden.
Wenn die westlichen Mächte, sowohl einzeln als auch gemeinsam, ihre Glaubwürdigkeit und ihren Einfluss wiederherstellen wollen, müssen sie sich nach innen auf eine bessere Regierungsführung konzentrieren und nach außen dafür sorgen, dass globale öffentliche Güter zuverlässig bereitgestellt werden. Und was sind die Wünsche und Hoffnungen für die Zukunft unserer Demokratie?
Ich wünsche mir von der Demokratie der Zukunft, dass jeder Bürger und jede Bürgerin die eigene Verantwortung in einer solchen Demokratie sieht, sie zu verteidigen und sie vor allem auch zu würdigen.
Von der Demokratie der Zukunft wünsche ich mir, dass sie sich nicht für selbstverständlich hält. Die Demokratie ist nicht einfach eine Dienstleistungsform, sondern eine politische Form, in der die unterschiedlichen Interessen auf zivilisierte Weise aufeinandertreffen und ergebnisoffen für Lösungen gekämpft wird.
Die Zukunft der Demokratie liegt vor uns und will gestaltet werden.
Nehmen Sie Platz, bitte.
Please, have a seat.
Verehrter Herr Bundespräsident, lieber Alexander
Van der Bellen, Mr. President, Alexander Van der Bellen, Liz Moon,
liebe Gäste,
dear guests, co-authors, curators, we're all horrified by the images and reports coming out of Kyiv, Kharkiv, Odessa, Mariupol and many other cities in Ukraine. The brutal war of aggression Russia's President Putin has been waging for more than 2 weeks, the many lives that this attack has cost, the suffering and destruction it has brought, all of this has shaken us to the very core. At this very moment, countless Ukrainians are risking their lives to defend their republic against Russian troops. The struggle people in Ukraine are engaged in against an aggressor with superior military might, this struggle is not only courageous, it also sets an example. It has demonstrated to the world in a dramatic fashion that freedom and democracy are not guaranteed for all eternity, and that they are under attack again today, not least because autocrats feel threatened by open societies. For many people in our country, in Europe and in the world of liberal democracies, Putin's war is a shock. However, this shock has not driven us apart or paralyzed us. Rather, what it has done is that it has brought us together and led us to act with greater resolve. We are currently seeing the liberal democracies in the European Union and in the Atlantic Alliance standing shoulder to shoulder to support Ukraine's independence, undertake action against a regime which has invaded another country with the aim of subjugating its citizens. We are seeing hundreds of thousands of people, women and children from Ukraine, seeking and finding refuge in the European Union. We are seeing millions of people all around Europe taking to the streets to demonstrate their desire for peace. We are seeing many people showing solidarity for Russians who do not want this war, who are suffering under its impact, who are courageously demonstrating their opposition to the dictatorial regime in Moscow, and who are being threatened with imprisonment and worse, for speaking the truth. This war of aggression, which is ever more evidently also affecting the civilian population in Ukraine, poses a challenge for us. There must be a response to this injustice, and this is what the vast majority of people, including in Germany, are very clear about.
The Putin begonnene Angriffskrieg bedeutet,
we too will have to pay a price for the war of aggression instigated by Putin, which marks a watershed moment. Not only is it our humanitarian solidarity, our readiness to take in people who have fled their homes, which is required once more, we must also be prepared to shoulder the economic cost for the necessary tough sanctions which isolate Russia will inevitably bring burdens, losses and uncertainties for us too. And what is more, we are faced with the challenge of strengthening our own defense capability and that of the alliance. The return of war to Europe teaches us that we have to be able to defend ourselves from attacks. Democracies must be capable of defending themselves even when diplomatic avenues open up. For we can only negotiate successfully from a position of strength, not from a position of weakness. I am always keen to share the wonderful quote, I trust many of you know it, from John F. Kennedy's inauguration speech, "Let us never negotiate out of fear, but let us never fear to negotiate." Ladies and gentlemen, in the shadow of the war in Ukraine, we want to take stock of our forum on the future of democracy. We want to look ahead. How can we strengthen the Republic and what must we do now to make liberal democracy, to make the European Union and the Atlantic Alliance fit for the future?
Here on this table,
there are just under 30 men and women from academia, culture, media and politics around this table today, all of whom have taken part in one of the 12 events of the Forum Bellevue in recent years. They live or work in Germany, Austria, Bulgaria, Hungary, the Netherlands, Italy, the United Kingdom or the United States. And they view liberal democracy and, of course, its opponents from different angles. And they also have standpoints which give us food for thought or provoke us into expressing our disagreement with. They all represent a culture of argumentative debate on which our democracy thrives. And I would even go as far as to say which lends its strength. During the last year, most of you have reformulated, updated and further developed the ideas you put forward in this room. And this has resulted in a book, a powerful 432 pages case for liberal democracy, a book which sets out ways towards a democratic future. I would like to thank everyone who has contributed to this forum and to this book, which bears the title On the Future of Democracy, 36 Perspectives, as participants and authors. And I would also like to thank the Bertelsmann Foundation, in particular you, Liz Moon, because I know that this series has been very close to your heart. We are grateful for the support, which, without which we would not have been able to organize a forum of this magnitude, nor a book project of this kind. Thank you very much to all of you. It is truly wonderful that almost all of you are gathered here today. In my address to the Federal Convention on the 13th of February, I said, and I quote, "The Russian president should not underestimate the strength of democracies." I had very good reasons to speak that note of warning. I also said, nor should we, my fellow Germans, underestimate the strength of our democracy. Undoubtedly, many of these topics will be discussed today. It is a great honor for me, ladies and gentlemen, to be able to welcome the President of the Republic of Austria to our gathering today. Dear Alexander Van der Bellen, we've spoken on the phone during the last few days, especially during the last few days. And I know how much you and the people of your country are worried and alarmed by the war. The fact that you're here today to outline to us your view of the state and the future of liberal democracy is not only a sign of friendship, it is also a demonstration, another demonstration really, of the cohesion within our European family. Alexander, I am pleased that you are here to engage with us today, and I'm delighted that we will have the pleasure of listening to you shortly and to listen to your ideas about the future of democracy. A very warm welcome to Berlin. Dear guests, what future does the West have? That was the question with which we opened the Forum Bellevue in September 2017. It seems a long time ago. Donald Trump had just taken office as President of the United States, and the government in London was initiating the United Kingdom's withdrawal from the European Union. Disagreements on the hosting of millions of refugees from the war in Syria were rocking the European community, and then many democracies, resentment, and illiberal forces were gaining followers. A new fascination with authoritarianism seemed to take hold. The COVID-19 pandemic that broke out in the spring of 2020 deepened existing rifts in our societies. It opened up new ones, and it showed how fragile trust in democratic institutions is. This trust has faded, at least amongst some members of our society. Meanwhile, the immense task of swiftly and systematically changing course in politics, industry and society in order to stop global warming is putting liberal democracy and our cohesion to another test. Experiencing obscurity and uncertainty, complexity and contingency, experiencing the fact that in our life and in our world, much is possible, but nothing can be taken for granted. These experiences, as I see it, are indeed not an argument against, rather a strong argument for liberal democracy. With regard to all the challenges I mentioned, I nevertheless continue to be confident because I believe that liberal democracy is the only political order in which we face up to the realities of the world as political equals and as free agents, in which we do not place our fate in the hands of others, but have confidence in our ability to resolve problems together, in which we learn from mistakes, above all, in which we are able to correct our course time and again, and precisely for these reasons can change things for the better. This makes for strenuous, painstaking work in day-to-day politics. Amid the daily toil of democracy, we do not always feel inspired by the noble values of this societal order. And yet, we are now seeing, especially these days, what we would lose if we gave up on them.
In a democracy,
we take society as it comes, in all of its diversity, with all of its contrasts and contradictions. We recognize ourselves, amid all of our individual differences, to be citizens who enjoy the same freedom to actively contribute to political decision-making. Dictatorships, on the other hand, know only devotees and enemies, servants or outcasts. Differences met with suspicion, contradiction seen as betrayal. Lively debate is increasingly supplanted by control, punishment, crippling fear and violence. In a democracy, we recognize that the people only ever exist in the plural. The will of the people is neither unequivocal nor simply already there. We must constantly re-establish it in procedures that are anything but perfect, and we have to time and again express it anew in open, imperfect processes by using arguments to fight for the best solution, negotiating conflicts of values, balancing interests, forging compromises. I believe that this is what makes a liberal society so good at peace, both internally and externally. Authoritarian nationalism, on the other hand, spins a web of ethno-nationalist lies in which the people become a historical myth and are ascribed collective traits and claims to ownership. Groups that deviate from this are declared enemies of the people and threatened with destruction. And this is what makes authoritarian nationalism so aggressive, both internally and externally. Now, if we give up, when we give up on democracy because it is too strenuous, we therefore lose not only our freedom, but ultimately also the possibility of living together peacefully in this world of cultural differences.
Dear guests,
at the end of the day, strengthening democracy also means identifying its conditions and defending its foundations. The erosion of these conditions and foundations does not begin with open violence. It begins before this, wherever lethargy and impatience, irritability and indifference gain the upper hand, and where the democratic mainstream loses its confidence. For liberal democracy to succeed, it needs institutions for the building of political will in which decisions can be made and responsibility can be taken for them. It needs strong parliaments and sharp minds who do not shy away from taking public office. It needs freedom for art and independent media that differentiate between facts and fake news, uncover disinformation, conspiracy theories, and allow many voices to be heard and reach a wide audience. It needs education, not least historical and political education, because it is sustained by enlightened, critical, confident citizens. Citizens who have the courage to avail themselves of their own powers of reason. Liberal democracy needs freedom for science and academia because it cannot solve real problems unless it is guided by demonstrable facts and well-founded normative judgments. And it needs the rule of law in which political power is subject to the law and we are protected from arbitrary state action. And first and foremost, Liberal democracy needs the active commitment, the active engagement of its citizens, of its men and women. It needs those men and women who view themselves not as customers or clients of their state, but as true citizens of their country who intervene, who participate and care about more than just themselves. Ladies and gentlemen, in these times, we must recall the values and strengths of our democracy. And above all, we must learn once again to fight for liberal democracy. We have better arguments than the enemies of open societies. Now, in particular, we must make freedom, autonomy, and human rights our common cause. Now, in particular, we must take the side of democracy.
After the peaceful revolutions in Central and Eastern Europe, the collapse of the Soviet Union and the end of the Cold War, many of us hoped that we were now experiencing some form of historical progress, that we were now on the path to a future of democracy and worldwide cooperation. And we hoped that this would not demand us to turn around again. This hope was illusory, as we have discovered. But that does not mean that it was false when we took it as our lodestar. On the contrary, the confident belief in the strength of freedom and democracy is something, and I'm firmly convinced of that, that we need all the more today. We have now understood, if we had not already, that peace and freedom cannot be taken for granted. They demand a price from us. They demand our personal commitment, and it falls to us, the citizens, to defend and strengthen liberal democracy. It falls to us to ensure that subsequent generations too will be able to live well and shape their own future on this planet. What we can do together and what we want to do, that is what we are about to discuss. But first of all, we will listen to you, Alexander van der Bellen. I am pleased to give you the floor
and
the microphone. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your attention.
Bundespräsident,
Mr. President,
lieber Frank, meine sehr geehrten Frank, Damen und Herren,
ladies and gentlemen,
auch ich möchte, bevor ich enger aufs Thema eingehe,
before I actually deal with the matter at hand, I would like to take a brief moment and think of all the people in Ukraine who right now fight for their very survival, for the survival of their of individuals, but also for the country itself. It breaks my heart to think of all of the innocent children, of mothers and fathers, people who simply only want to live in peace, but who for days had had to be to hunker down and find shelter in cellars, in shelters, in subway stations. This is horrible. It is despicable. How did we get here?
Lieber Herr Bundespräsident, lieber Frank Walter,
dear Federal President, dear Frank-Walter, thank you very much for inviting me to this event where we can discuss and think about liberal democracies and the fate of liberal democracies. I don't think many people would have seriously envisaged only a few weeks ago that we would live through a war of aggression in Europe right now. Much of what we thought were internal truths is now cast into doubt. And as you quite rightly say, said in your speech, dear Frank, what we now need is common sense. We need to defend ourselves, we need to defend our liberal democracies, we need to show respect for what we have, we need to be careful and mindful of how we address these matters and how we speak to others, but we also have to show a willingness to negotiate. You mentioned a very important quote by Kennedy, let us never negotiate out of fear, but let us never fear to negotiate. Those are beautiful words, and Kennedy knew very well, he knew only too well what he talked about. You also said, and I quote, liberal democracy is the only political order in which we as a political free individuals and equal individuals can face up to the facts, to the realities of the day, where we do not place our fate into the hands of others, but where we have the ability to stand together and solve problems together by learning from our own mistakes, by correcting our course, and in this way trying to turn things and change them for the better. And this is why we need a common understanding what a problem actually is, a common understanding understanding of what reality actually is that we all face together.
Also ich hätte vor 20 Jahren nicht geglaubt,
20 years ago, I would never have thought that we would at some point in time have to deal with a situation where scientific discoveries, facts, are not only questioned, but are actively denied. Really actively denied to be true, not only by a few oddballs, but by a significantly large number of people, even some political players, some politicians, so that the whole of our system underpinning of our values, underpinning our societies, our state, are cast into doubt. And for every fact, there is all of a sudden an alternative fact matching it. I think this disparages intellect. Only 30 years ago, one spoke about the end of history. Today, you have to acknowledge that we seem to live in an era of contradictory alternative stories and narratives. In looking back, I think one can safely say this was not the end of history. It was rather the beginning of, well, historical narratives. Narratives that are seemingly of equal value to be chosen at liberty as if they were consumer goods in some supermarket. Narratives that are sometimes so mind-boggling that one is at a loss to understand how anyone can seriously believe them. These narratives are packaged, embellished, then sealed in plastic, painted in various shades of credibility, constitute the fabric that for many that seem to be reality. They seem to consider it to be real. They are not assembled by our selective perception, but by algorithms, algorithms that drive the by now seemingly dominant form of conveying information and acquiring information, the so-called social media. Am I the only one? I'm the last one to actually condemn social media per se. I don't think I would have actually been able to win in the presidential election campaign without the support of social media, just to make this clear. But they also have a very different side to them. They have become, in a way, a digital veil drawn by many between themselves and reality. A veil that filters and changes their view of the world, that offers time and again information that doesn't necessarily have to be true, that seems to be of secondary importance, but to create as much of a stir as possible, to draw people's attention to them, because attention obviously means you stay longer on that specific medium, and when you stay longer on that specific medium, it means that the person owning that particular medium makes more of a profit. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think it is simply totally undignified for a liberal democracy to allow these algorithms to have a massive determining influence, at least on the awareness of many of us, but that we simply don't know how they actually work, how they actually are built. We only see the effect, we see the impact. And if we look and carefully analyze at the effect, let me say this very brutally, very bluntly, the only conclusion is lies are used to make a profit. Facts and truths become relative, and excitement is turned into a sham reality. And this has to stop. Maybe I'm exaggerating. I'd be very happy to hear from you that I am exaggerating, if you can calm my nerves. It is possible, after all, that this ignorance is only a partial one, that there's only one particular area where these strange views due to algorithms are held, only in one particular area of our society, or that on a very specific point I have this divergent views, that generally around I am a sensible person, I'm also quite a nice person, I know people like that. But the question is, am I actually making a mountain out of a molehill, or is this actually really, over the long run, a true danger to our democracies? If that were true, then we should be very clear and should name it as such and not gloss it over. In this particular sense, we ought to perhaps use categories such as truth and lie, because they don't only play a very important role right now. In Russia, the censors do not allow to speak of a war. But what else is this, what we are witnessing? But there are still people who simply do not wish to use the word climate crisis, who completely deny that there is a human-made climate crisis that we see. And this is not just fake news and a little bit that can be laughed at. It is simply potentially fatal for the whole of mankind to believe in these lies. So the enemies of democracy are actually turning their facts upside down. They're turning truths upside down. They're making things relative that shouldn't be relative. And perhaps we have become too tolerant in exactly the wrong way. It's not only politicians who have to shoulder responsibility there and who have to be held accountable. I would go one step further. So-called fake news are stories that one simply relays, that one simply tells other people. But those who spread those stories simply wash their hands of it. They seem not to be responsible. It's not just the medium. It's just people behind that, the people who actually use those media and who, without actually filtering news, pass them on. Each and everyone who is spreading those fake news bears responsibility. Because he or she is a sender, is therefore somebody who multiplies those narratives. And this individual responsibility has a lot to do with the underpinnings of our democracy, because each and everyone in a democracy is responsible for democracy to actually work in practice. It is not something that we are born with, and it will function, it will work, but the way we act, the way we speak to one another, that decides whether democracy is possible or not. As federal president, I am. It is incumbent upon me to be neutral, to choose my words carefully, to be above the general fray. But sometimes it's very difficult. And in Austria, as in many other countries as well, in the course of this pandemic, there have been demonstrations. That's a basic right. We will never question the right of peaceful assembly. But what about those who quite purposefully and systematically try to tell people that they live in a dictatorship? I still remember those pictures. Freedom, dictatorship. Freedom means you ignore the pandemic. Dictatorship is what politicians have tried to do in order to protect the health system from collapsing completely. In Ukraine, people take to the streets. They are actually standing up against the tanks, because they don't want to live in a dictatorship. So I don't think we ought to relativize these terms, dictatorship. We ought to make a distinction between truth and lie, because only in this way can we actually see reality as it is. And I know this is difficult. It is difficult to see reality as it is, but this is the very basis of life in freedom and peace. Democracy cannot be tolerant in the long run towards people who deny facts, towards liars. Each and everyone is born in, as you know, is born with the inherent basic rights, and these rights are inviolable, as the Charter of Human Rights says. And these rights of freedom, these basic rights, are the very underpinnings of a liberal democracy. And over the past 2 years, it was apparently very difficult to explain to many people that there may be conflicts between different basic rights, between the right of freedom and the basic right of health. There is a conflict, a very clear conflict in a pandemic between freedom and equality, and there is always a conflict, and we as politicians need to strike the right balance there.
dass die Politik, wenn sie hier eine Abwägung trifft,
politicians, when they weigh things in the balance and weigh the different pros and cons of upholding this basic right against this one, that is not a dictatorship. It is incumbent upon us. So we need also to protect the rules, the rights of minorities. And for this, we need rule of law. Austria, it's our constitutional court that upholds this. And a number of people have actually actively brought legal proceedings before the court. And sometimes the complainants were actually proved right and sometimes not. Sometimes the ruling came in their favor and sometimes not. If I take this too seriously, please don't hesitate to say, but Alexander, it's not that serious as you think. In conclusion, allow me the following remark. There is obviously very clearly the need for dialogue, to talk to one another, even though it may sometimes take very long. It is said time and again, democracy takes too long, there's too much of a fight, I can't hear this anymore, leave me alone with this, but that just having one individual deciding everything at the very top, that would be far more sensible. But in our system, it is excluded that a head of state actually acts against one's own people, that people are imprisoned simply because they voice their opinion, that you start a war that your own people do not want. Because if this were not the case, then he would, in Russia, you would not need censorship.
Karl Popper, the
Austrian-British philosopher at some point in time said, you can choose whatever name you like for the two types of government. I personally call the type of government which can be removed without violence democracy and the other tyranny. Yes, democracy is a cumbersome business. It is arduous. It challenges us. It needs listening to one another. It needs grappling with one another. It needs compromise, honest compromise. And this is why we shouldn't denounce a compromise automatically as one that is a false compromise. Standing together, trying to solve problems, that is the true strength of democracy. And if the purportedly strong man alone takes decisions and there is no democratic underpinning, no security, then we see now what is happening. So democracy is strength. Talking to one another is strength. Discourse is strength. That is what makes us strong. Talking to one another, being able to talk to one another in a sensible dialogue, we need to at least have a common understanding of what reality is. Thank you very much.
Thank you, dear Alexander. Our work is over. Now it's your turn. You may have just realized that this event, in the framework of which we are meeting, was planned for an earlier point in time. But then, because of the rise in infections, we took the decision to put this off a wee bit. And when we put it off to this particular date, of course, it brought up the question that automatically springs to mind. Is this topic not being, you know, in a way pushed to the sidelines because of the war? I think these topics, and that's my response, are much more linked than people may have thought at a first glance. And I think that that will become obvious in the course of today's debate. So I will ask you a few questions in that regard, if you permit. If I may, I would like to begin because we began because we started as Germans and as Austrians, we would perhaps also continue a bit down that road because someone who was born in Munich and lived there but tends to be more present in New York if he doesn't happen to be in Berlin. Daniel Kehlmann, I found an old interview with you. I think it was an interview. It's an interview that goes back to the time where you had just published your book Till and were busy promoting your book. Amongst others, you gave an interview to the Süddeutsche
Zeitung, and I'd like to quote from that interview. You said at the time to the interviewer from the Süddeutsche Zeitung, if it's right to say that there is a collective subconscious, then the war appears to be rather a trauma instead of being a commandment never again, but a trauma doesn't make people more peaceful. On the contrary, it makes them more violent. And I think we underestimate the value of the status quo. And you, at the time, were quite open to the conception, to the idea of having another war take place before your life ends. And you close that passage by saying, the concern about a seemingly stable order is something that is close to my heart, and that is one of the reasons why I've been focusing on the 30-year war. What did you know at the time, Mr. Kehlmann? We hadn't known. Well, indeed, I hadn't known anything at all. Perhaps being an author, you tend to know a little bit more than one other people seem to know. Perhaps you have a kind of feeling or a sense for certain things, but it might also have been just by chance, you know, happenstance. When we now speak about instability and imminent threats and dangers, what struck me is that President Van der Bellen is my other president, because I have the Austrian passport and the German passport, so both my presidents are here today. I'm deeply moved by that, I have to say. The fact that Mr. Van der Bellen spoke of the algorithms, you know, that is something that I've felt of late. I've started to feel, I think for 2 days now, 1 or 2 days now, I have received the most incredible propaganda videos from friends in America. Lies contained in propaganda videos about Ukrainian fascists. And as I said, it's only just begun. And they ask me, is this the truth? The moment I look at these videos, my YouTube channel, you know, recommendations I get from YouTube fills up with horrible propaganda videos. Really, you know, you see with your own eyes how the algorithm, and there is no human force behind it, it's the algorithm that's working here, is trying to convince me, because any kind of prejudice that he thinks is there is immediately being strengthened and reinforced in order to make it more prominent. So what we're experiencing, what we're seeing on all sides is something like that. A friend of mine said that a demonstration of opponents to the vaccination against COVID-19 appeared with placards saying, don't take Nord Stream 2 away from us. So the Russian agents in a way are doing their work, but the algorithms are doing the same. This convincing moral clarity regarding to who is the aggressor, who is the victim, which seems to be crystal clear to all of us. But I'm very concerned. Let the internet work and take its course for 2 years, for 2 months' time, and then take another look at what is clear and what is less clear. I'm really, really afraid here. You might well remember, as I do, that on the 13th of February, an event took place, the Federal Assembly, the Federal Convention met, and I prepared for my speech to the Federal Convention, which was a difficult speech at a difficult point in time. I think that was a week before the war began, but nevertheless, people felt it in the air. Things were coming to a head. And on the one hand, it was clear to me that what we had been preparing for this day could not be the speech I was going to deliver, whereas on the other hand, I wasn't anything but clear about what I was in a position to say and what I would have to say, you know, awaiting things to happen or to come to a head. And what I said, Mr. Putin, don't underestimate the strength of democracy, was one of the sentences that I found very hard to make and to say, because I wasn't clear at the time, is this self-confidence or is this wishful thinking on my part? Perhaps it's a bit of both. Anyway, with hindsight, I'm very clear, and this is why I said earlier that this war about which we are talking about, to which we've referred in our speeches today, and the defense of democracy and defending democracy are not just things that happens somewhere else in a far-off place. It's something that is of immediate effect to us these days. So do you think my first observation is right? Because you, Alexander, spoke of that. Do you think my observation is right when I said that the shock, us being so aghast about this war actually breaking out, the fact that with this step back into earlier stages of our history with something that came unexpected to us, is it true to say that this has brought democracies closer to each other, or do you think that that is an exaggeration on my part? Mrs. Schwarzer. Thank you, Mr. President. I think that this observation is right. In this dark moment, I think we need to have a little bit of optimism. On the one hand, you see how strong Ukraine is, and I think in the last couple of years, we received many critical reports about the country, which were true to some extent, and therefore did not get the complete picture about the country. Remember what happened in 2014, the Euromaidan, and I believe that it triggered a lot of good and positive developments. When you now take a look at this present situation in Ukraine, and I do speak from a personal position, there is a foundation that works for democracy in Ukraine, and I work with that foundation. And we see on the one hand not only our staff members being very engaged and committed on the ground, many rejected the offer we extended to them to leave the country and to move to a safe place, but also the networks that this foundation helped establish are very active, defending their country, defending their democracy, working to maintain peace. And when you take that look across the border, when you look to what is happening in Poland day in, day out, in order to, you know, this is a process that is borne by the citizens themselves. They want to become members of the European Union. People are being received in Poland with open arms. And the same is true for the main station here in Berlin, if you were to go there. People are there and greet the incoming Ukrainians with open arms. So civil society, too, is engaged here. Are we simply moved, says the president, because moved and touched by the humanitarian catastrophe? No, no, and I'll get to that in a moment. When you take a look at the political assessment of the conflict, this is not about Ukraine. It is about the attempt undertaken to destroy democracy and freedom on our continent, and that attempt is being managed by President Putin. And there's a very clear position taken by the Europeans to put an end to that and to stand up to this attempt. Last week, I went to attend a meeting of ECOFIN. I'd been invited originally to speak about China, and then, of course, we spoke about Russia and Ukraine. And the way in which 27 finance ministers spoke about geopolitics touched me deeply. This deep consensus that you could feel, that was the basis of their attempts, their need, their realization that we have to set out on paths we've never tread on before, and we have to throw overboard a few things because of what's happened here. We should not exclusively focus on restricting our expenditure, but we have to carefully consider what needs to be done now to preserve what we have achieved. Just briefly, if I may, a critical observation that I'd like to share with you, because you said President Putin or Mr. Putin underestimated the resilience and the strength of democracy. What our democracies did over the course of the last 2 years is to underestimate the threat that autocracies pose to us. When you look at the articles published by Putin since 2014, what he has done now cannot have come as a surprise. Perhaps the brutality, but the brutality was open there. The strategy was described by him there. Also, the parallel approach in our thoughts about China, step for step. For years now, we have been seeing us also underestimating this strategy pursued by China, although we've been analyzing it for years. Based on the desire on our part, this cannot happen because we don't want it to happen. It cannot be true because we don't want it to be true. Serious scenarios would have to be assessed in an analytical manner. And then it is the next step to make it public knowledge, which will be difficult. But we have to do so, because otherwise we are not sufficiently prepared for such an eventuality. And part and parcel of that is the ongoing discussion which we've been having now for almost 8 years about energy security in Europe. So I believe that on the one hand we have to take a look at what we have by now. We see that sense of unity of democracies to defend their democracies. At the same time we have to realize how vulnerable we are. So much is happening in our discussion about European autonomy, the resilience of democracies, that they are threatened from the inside by people using hybrid means. But what we're experiencing, what we're living right now, is a moment where we are pretty clear about the threats and we are in the midst of mobilizing our strength. Thank you, Wolfgang Merkel. I wanted to have the floor. Just a minute, if I may. If I may ask Mr. McEwan first and foremost what the British viewpoint is. How do things look from the United Kingdom? Kingdomshore, when we last met, we spoke about the trenches, the rifts that were created by the exit from the European Union, Britain's exit from the European Union. Do the people in the United Kingdom are aware of the fact that we are acting as members of the community of shared values, as parts of the European Union, or does Great Britain, United Kingdom, feel closer to the United States these days?
Well, as you know, we have been going through a moment of deep shame when we witnessed the welcome given to civilians fleeing Ukraine in the last 2 weeks, and only slowly, under the massive pressure of public opinion, is our government beginning to make things a little easier, but not as easy as we would want. The events of the last 2 weeks have been as colossal and shattering and all-absorbing in the UK, and I know from American friends as well. But we do face certain problems here, because we're talking about unity. Our politicians speak warmly of unity, but they have just been engaged on a massive political project of anti-unity, of stepping back from the EU. The country was more or less equally divided on this step, and it more or less remains so. So we're in a difficult position here. We have not made those steps that from Moldova to Calais are evident on our screens. But what I think of this in the broader sense, and I take on board everything has been said so far, for example, about social media and the extraordinary inhuman power of algorithms. But it falls to willing ears. And I think of us now living through a time in which we appear to be waking up from a sleep. There are things that we now remember to love. And I think of that wonderful old Joni Mitchell song, "You don't know what you've got till it's gone." And I think that could be the song of our times. Those willing ears for all those conspiracy theories and hostility to science and hostility to elected governments has partly, I think, got its roots in the fact that capitalism in our democracy is immensely successful at generating wealth, immensely successful at generating invention, but ruthlessly poor, especially in the Anglo-American sphere, of distributing wealth and of distributing invention. So we have large sections of our populations who have not participated in year-on-year growth of opportunity and wealth. And I think they are the willing petri dish for conspiracy. If I think too of how we manage and think and try to understand the present, it sometimes helps to imagine oneself 150 years in the future, standing in a library, looking at the books, looking at the history books. I had thought, for example, that I would see history books with, you know, with these years, Europe 1989, the fall of the wall, the greatest surge in human optimism about politics of my lifetime. And I thought they would end with 2006, the assault on the Capitol last year in Washington. And that would seem to me like a slow decline from our most cherished optimism to a sudden moment of recognition that something is fundamentally wrong in one of the world's most powerful democracies. Now I'm beginning to think I'm going to read the history book, and it's going to be 1989 to 2022, when Europe woke up from a sleep. It has all these cherished freedoms, and in that sleep of cherished freedoms, it outsourced, for example, its energy or good part of its energy to Russia. It outsourced its security to the United States. It outsourced its cheap manufacturing to China, causing great distress, again, in that petri dish of discontent of ordinary people right across Europe, right across the UK, and certainly right across the United States, who were losing their jobs and who were therefore not part of this project, which we all feel so deeply involved with now. So if I were to reach for some notion of optimism, if we come through this, if we push back on Putin's grisly project, it would be to say that the future of democracy is actually going to have to be about improving it in terms of quite basic things like wealth and opportunity. Because without it, there will be endlessly this highly receptive negative sense of reason, a great movement within democracies against science, against expertise, and unless we address that, I think democracy will always be very frail and extremely argumentative and extremely vulnerable.
Vielen Dank. Vielen Dank.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, Wolfgang Merkel.
Ich stimme Ian McEwan.
I very much agree with Ian McEwan on all the points that he has raised. And I'm happy to do so, especially when we speak about capitalism and democracy. But I'd also like to come back to what Mrs. Schwarz has said. Does the West stand together? I would say it depends. It also depends, I believe, on how long the war is going to be drawn out, how long it's going to take, how long negative effects, distortions, and negative impacts will be felt in our societies, which brings us back to democracy, because democracy gives people the right to protest against political measures. It also allows the expression of different interests, and the doing so publicly. And there will be different interests between people who are wealthy and those who are less wealthy, those who are better educated and those who are less well educated, those who have a greater share in the wealth of our country and those who have a smaller share. The longer the war lasts, the longer it's going to take, these will become obvious. So in a way, democracies contain certain functional weaknesses, if you want to describe it as such. But there is another aspect, a foreign policy aspect that comes into the play here. In 1994, we spoke about how we can share the dividend of justice in as fair as manner, of peace in as fair as manner as possible. Now we talk about how can we achieve such a peace dividend. For many years, we've thought that we can in a way place on a legal basis our foreign relations with other countries. So it was an opposition between the power of the law and power per se. And in that attempt, we overlooked the fact that a geopolitical attack was on the horizon. Look to Mr. Kissinger, look to Mr. Münkler. They have pointed to the need for putting a political approach on the agenda that we had thought we had paid to, and that is spheres of influence, a policy based on the recognition of spheres of influence. And that is very difficult to place on a legal basis. President Putin, the Russian regime, have to end the war, but this approach of having spheres of influence will make it difficult, also make it difficult that a movement of democracy in a way can bring to the knees the regime in Moscow, the regime in Russia. What is likely is that in a country where democracy has not been able to organize itself, where there are no powerful actors, that a kind of chaos will erupt in times of transition. These are all factors that we have to bear at the back of our mind and that we have to be aware of them playing perhaps a part. And I'm afraid that the longer this war lasts, the more obvious the differences between the individual democracies in the way in which they shape the interests and express the interests will become obvious.
Susan Neiman nochmal fragen.
I would like to ask Susan Neiman, I think if we look at Washington and the two administration and the Biden administration, we are fairly confident in saying, and I suppose the White House itself would put it in those words, that liberal democracies are standing much closer together than they ever have, looking at this conflict that we now see, at this war against Ukraine. But later on, we will perhaps discuss also the future of American democracy and how you see it. But for now, let me ask the question, to what extent does this interest the American public, this war? What are their comments, positions? And does this actually lead to more of a closeness to the Europeans in the broader public, or is this too much hope that I'm voicing here? I believe that well, the media are full of it. All of my friends and colleagues are busy dealing with this, following events, so there's no doubt about that. The question, however, is what sort of impact does this have on the shape of democracy? Those who really watch the news on the American television screens have been complaining about this for quite some time. I'm always for self-criticism rather than pointing a finger at others. I'd like to come back to what Daniel said on moral clarity, a word that I love. Moral clarity is one of my favorites, and I think it's much easier to say in English than in German. This clarity right now is very welcome. I have the feeling that both in the US and here, people heave a sigh of relief. Finally, there's a clear-cut difference between good and bad. There is a front line that is clear-cut. But even if Putin used the Iraq war in a very cynical way and exploited it for his own purposes, there he was right. That was a breach of international law. It was a precedence that was created then. International law applies to each and everyone, be it a European nation or not. It may very well be that Putin would have attacked Ukraine. Nevertheless, even had the West over the past 30 years acted in perfect respect of international law. But probably the whole thing would have collapsed much earlier. What we've seen over the past years, at the very latest ever since the Iraq war, is an erosion of moral clarity all round, which makes it much easier for dictators to hold their own. I would warn against this sigh of relief which says, finally, we know where the baddies are. They're over there. We have to actually bring our own house in order, which doesn't mean, obviously, not to support Ukraine. We have to support it as much as we can. Wolfgang Merkel just now addressed this issue of spheres of influence. There's a lot of speculation about what the possible motive, the possible goal of Russia might be. And one of the reasons that are sometimes quite mind-boggling reasons that are given, but the central element in the line of argument of the Kremlin purportedly is that they feel threatened by NATO and increasingly so. Over the past few years, when you've been in this business for a longer period of time and you think back, then you know that the big enlargements of NATO took place in 1990 and 2004. Those were significant enlargements. And I remember that even after 2004, there were intergovernmental consultations between the Russian and the German governments. There have been regular meetings, meetings of the European Council with the Russian government, including the then president. So in looking back, if memory doesn't fail, the big enlargement, the two big enlargements of NATO were not apparently what triggered this disturbance, this unrest, and simply kicking up North Macedonia can also not be a problem. But there must be something else through which an autocracy such as Russia feels so immensely challenged. Earlier in my speech, I mentioned the openness of our societies, the fact that in a political debate, it's an open debate, also an open-ended debate. Mr. Nassehi wrote on this, Ivan Krastev is writing quite a lot about this. So perhaps in this sequence, I would ask you to comment on this. Well, actually, an open-ended discussion, Mr. President, that is certainly something which I would describe not maybe as an empirical fact, but as a self-descriptive element of liberal democracies, not only as regards democracy, but also other parts of our societies. Our economies, for example, are very much based on an open-ended discourse. Science, culture, even our law, our legislation is in a way never sort of finite, but can be constantly changed. And that has something with it's not a monolithic block which now faces another one. Empirically speaking, I'd be more interested to take a closer look at how much energy you have to mobilize in order to, when we look at societies, modern societies, to suppress this element of an open-ended discourse. There's a huge consumption of energy in a democracy that you need in order to suppress ideas, economies, for example, that there's a huge amount of energy that needs to be generated to make an economy small. And that is what the Russian economy is all about. Maybe I'm exaggerating a little bit, but you need an open mind and open-ended creativity to generate economic success as well. That has a lot to do with what Mr. McEwan said earlier on. A self-confidence of societies and how they see themselves becomes ever more difficult, it's also difficult to have to generate a discourse that again is open-ended. Now let us come back to: is this really a return to the rationale? That is what Kant says. A natural state is something that by law cannot be in any way regulated. So that is probably something that in the way that we live inside and how we see ourselves to the exterior, that is something that we need to come up with words for. We've seen these terrible images from Maria Mariupol, where this hospital was bombed, this maternity ward where this pregnant woman was carried out. We also see this child in the street in Vietnam with the napalm bomb. And these clearly constitute breaches of every rule of civilized conduct. And it triggered a reaction within a democracy. So it allowed us to also criticize ourselves. And that is something that we really ought to appreciate. The structural weakness of a democracy actually ought to be appreciated by us, Mr. Merkel, because it actually leads to a discourse that is open-ended and that maybe we have understood, we have forgotten, is actually a virtue of a democracy. So, Ivan Krastev now has the floor.
Thank you very much. And for me, it's quite important that this type of an openness of a democracy is a major advantage. It can be turned also against it. Weaponization of mistrust is basically what we're going to see coming. Because those people who basically don't believe what the governments or the mainstream media is saying about Russia or Ukraine or about vaccines and so on, they're not ready to trust anything there because they have made a major conclusion about life is that the governments and mainstream media are not to be trusted. And this is a basic decision. So now people are shocked. Listen, people have normal moral sensitivities. So even if you're mistrustful when you see a big nuclear country attacking their neighbors and destroying the cities and using the language, but if we're going to have this in 3 months, in 4 months, people try to trivialize what is going on. They're going to say, yes, Russians are doing this, but we are doing this too, and we like this, and we like that. And in my view, this is this situation in which, and I very much agree that the problem of social cohesion, it's not that we're not sharing the same reality with the Russians. We're not sharing the same reality within our own societies. Mm-hmm. And for me, this is the major story. We talk about resilience. I do believe it's a very important concept. It's so beautiful because it's so vague. So from this point of view, what is resilience? And for me, first is know your society. And know your society in a painful way. Not only in the moment of a romantic kind of a mobilization, and this is, but also basically how it is going to be in 6 months in kind of a 1 year. Secondly, resilience is not about defending status quo in the way it is. Mm-hmm. I'm very much afraid that we can go easily on this way. Yeah. Because we are attacked, we should try to claim that everything that we did is right, or every institutions that we have should remain in the way it is. And the third thing which is also important for me is, in this world in which basically we are weaponizing the things that connect us, it's not so much how much you can hurt the other side. The problem is how pain you are ready to endure yourself. This is also the problem of the sanctions. The success of the sanctions is, if we're going to survive the sanctions our way, basically convincing our society that it's worth sacrificing. And what struck me with the Ukrainian example is, exactly, if you go 6 months ago, what most of the people believed about Ukraine? It's messy. It's corrupt. It's a nice place, but they never managed to have a state. And then all these kind of, and then you see people who are ready to die for something. You see a president who said, I'm not going to leave Kiev. Everybody was telling him to leave Kiev. And this kind of a touching on the people that there's things that is worth dying, in my view, are critical because words like freedom, like sovereignty, we have given this to people protesting against the vaccination or to truck drivers in Canada. These are important words. And if we're talking about moral clarity is about knowing what we're all about. And then I'm going just on the last point you make about your looking back in the international order. And when something happens, it pushes you to look back and try to see what you have got wrong. And in my view, what we got wrong was that we took three things to be one and the same thing. Basically, the end of communism, the end of the Cold War, and the end of the Soviet Union. Communism is dead. And basically, one of its major critics is Russian President Vladimir Putin, who 10 days ago had a fiercely anti-communist speech. So he didn't speak attacking Ukraine as a red colonel. He speak as a white guard general, saying that the Russians were the major victims of the Soviet Union and so on. Basically, this was the famous memorandum of the Serbian Academy of late 1980s. Cold War ended and international order was established in 1990 with the peaceful unification of Germany, but on the other side was not Russia. On the other side was Soviet Union. And Soviet Union was interested in this order because President Gorbachev believed that by joining international or liberal order, he can save the Soviet Union. This is what he was about, because this international order was anti-nationalist, because he believes that joining this is going to allow him to have a post-communist Soviet Union. It didn't work like this. And I do believe it's not true that the West destroyed the Soviet Union. Bush Sr. basically was praying to the Ukrainians not to get independent because of fear of proliferation of the nuclear weapons. But the story is it happened. And now when we say that we don't know what President Putin is doing, it's also not true. You connected all of us and published a book. President Putin is slightly more kind of alone in his effort of writing. He published an essay.
You think he will not read this book?
he published an essay. And if you're going to read carefully his essay of this July, everything is there. It's not, to be honest, about democracy and authoritarianism. It's about recreating Russian, historic Russia. He didn't forgive democratic Ukraine. By the way, he didn't forgive also authoritarian Belarus, because the annexation of Belarus is also something that happened in front of our eyes, and we didn't talk about it. So in a certain way, he's not living in the world of Cold War. He's living in a decolonization war. It's a classical recolonization war. I do believe that Ambassador of Kenya in the United Nations was the best one to recognize what we are talking about. And if this is the case, we should be also prepared to speak in these terms, because he's not framing it in the way it is. It's about demographic fears. Not enough Russians in the world, so you should get basically Slavic population back. It is about Ukraine cannot be a state. Belarus cannot be a state. And my fear is that we have lost the words talking about this because we became so cautious about words. That now moral clarity also means that you should name things. And naming things is, in my view, one of the things that democracies at the moment are not great at. So sorry for being slightly long.
Ja, vielen Dank, Alexander.
Thank you, Alexander, please.
I last year, but his two speeches he gave in the week of invasion. And I came more or less to the same conclusion. He wants to build Russia again, but in Russia before 1917. But this opens the question, how long will the war be with us? Because the Ukrainians, if you take away the statehood of Ukraine, and Ukraine should be a province of Russia, the Ukrainians will not accept that. So in that case, they might take Kiev, the Russian troops might take Kiev, but they will have a guerrilla war within Ukraine for years to come. Will Putin survive that? I'm asking that because in the Soviet times, at least you had a structure. You had the Secretary General on top, but you had the Politburo and the Central Committee. And if the Secretary General is, for some reason, is not wanted anymore, you could replace him. Now I don't see any structure at all in Russia. How do you see that?
Very much. I was also reading carefully this essay, and it's amazing in text. By the way, he has written it himself. Every single word, no speechwriters, no editors. At least this is what some people are telling us from Moscow. And from this point of view, I do believe we're making the mistake because Mr. Putin comes from intelligence agency to try to take him metaphorically. He should be taken literally. And what he is saying, even after the first 5 days of the war, he said, I still believed that Ukrainians and Russians are the same people. Mm-hmm. When the head of the American intelligence, Mr. Burns, yesterday said that he was planning to get Kyiv in 2 or 3 days, this is exactly because he didn't have an idea what is happening in Ukraine. He really believed that you have these pro-Western colonial elites which are repressing the Ukrainian people. So the moment the Russians will come, it's going to be like in Crimea. Mm. And in my view, this is the problem of understanding, because he's paying now the price of not getting on what is going on in Crimea. We paid the price of not understanding what is going on in Russia. And then we are now moving from one extreme to the other. I don't know how much he's going to survive. The level of repression in Russia is incredible. For example, I talking to some friends, and they said, why Russians are not in millions on the streets? Protesting the war now can bring up to 15 years in prison. How many of us will go on the streets to protest something that we really disapprove if it's going to bring you 15 years in prison? So from this point of view, it's very easy to moralize from a distance. And one of the things that we are not doing is really acknowledging the courage of the Russians who are doing this. Mm-hmm. And listen, this is not the professional politicians. Some of the people who are basically going, students, all of them are going to be out of universities. So he can survive for three reasons for a while. First, because historically we'll know that in this type of a confrontation, the first instinct of every nation is stay behind the leader. This was true in Iran. This was true even in Serbia with Milosevic. The first months are there. You blame sanctions on the other side. The second is the China factor that we didn't talk about. Behind him, there is a kind of another great power, which at least for the moment stays behind him. But in the long term, I do believe his project is dead. He never told the Russians what he'll do. The most surprised people by the war was not the Europeans. It was the Russians, including part of the Russian elites. Mm. He didn't prepare them for this war. He cannot explain why they're there. All this denazification talk, all this nuclear weapons talk. Listen, it is just absurd. And from this point of view, I do believe that, and we made one mistake in 30 years ago, believing that the only possibility for Russia is to become a democratic state. Now, in my view, we go into the other extreme, saying that there is no any other option for Russia than to be a kind of authoritarian state. There are more options, good and bad. And from this point of view, we should be slightly more tentative what is happening in other societies, because otherwise we can make the same mistake twice.
Herr Möllers.
Nur einen Satz dazu. Ich meine, wir haben, glaube ich, auch immer noch so ein bisschen das Framing.
Just one sentence on this. I think we still have the framing of 89, because we see how dictatorships fall, but we don't really have that much evidence that dictatorships actually fall. We have these rebellions that fail in many, many countries. There's still Lukashenko in power. Maduro is also there. We always thought, well, this is going to erode in Venezuela, but it didn't really. So it might be interesting to analyze carefully why. Is it technological reasons? A dictatorship that nobody likes anymore usually collapses, but that is no longer evident over the past 15 years, which is not a good thing. There are not that many counterexamples. You would not probably accept the Gambia as a case in point. Well, we will come later on to those points where we expect actually a contribution by you later on, climate and so on. Well, of course, yes, please. I think I will probably later on be asked to comment on the environmental issues, but right now I'd like to step in because we were talking about spheres of influence and power and also the question, why are dictatorships toppled, why are they collapsing, and how do we see power? I think what's lacking here is the parastatal level. And I mean, I don't know whether I would agree saying that economics are open-ended as regards the results. I think the concentration through economic power and the fact that we have enormous concentration of wealth and prosperity and then of spheres of influence and the social media are obviously profit-oriented. Facebook papers need to be read by each and every one of us to really see how power and finances are concentrated these days. We have to, yes, develop a consensus on democracy and this consensus can be readily lost. costs. I don't think we clearly see, Christoph, to come back to you, why regimes, unfortunately, are no longer toppled or can no longer be toppled by a society. That brings us to the oligarchs. We have to understand how a parastatal organization through control of resources, through control of finances, through communications, that actually ought to be the backbone of a society that we created, how that can prevent such a toppling. But it's very central, basic underpinnings of public goods can be concentrated and can also be manipulated in this way. So I think this question of actually an open-ended discourse and development and is a very crucial one. Who actually has access to this infrastructure, to this open-ended discourse? If we look at the way that we see the world these days, we have to see that those who actually guide those enterprises, they have a libertarian view of the world. So a political control but in their view, ought to be eliminated out of the life of individuals. That is something that we need to look at, because we still think in terms of nation states, and there is very clearly right now a power concentration in the digital world that is in clear contradiction to the control of democratic institutions. Armin Nassehi has asked for the floor. Allow me, if I may, to perhaps lump together Mr. McEwan's comments, your comments, and those of Ms. Schwarzer. When we say this is a watershed moment, does that mean that this dream of ever-growing international cooperation is also now destroyed and that globalization actually leads to more international cooperation? Is this a call upon nations to think in nation-state terms? Well, maybe, says Mr. Nassehi, cooperation is thought of more in nation-state formats. If we look, for example, at the history of how this has developed, political cooperation of states that obviously are bound by common interests of an economic nature or political nature. But I would agree with Maja Göpel in saying that in all areas, in all walks of life of our society, we have concentrations that actually question the fact that there is an open-ended discourse and an open-ended development. We have to see the potential of those areas where this is possible. I don't think that economies will simply shrink. We cannot replace nationalisms against other nationalisms. Democracies cannot simply be introduced or imposed. That is maybe the blind spot that we never see. Democracies, as we have them, and I think we ought to indeed appreciate them much more than we've done so far, this can certainly not become a role model for each and everyone, but at least parts of it ought to be integrated maybe in other societies. Mr. Kostov quite rightly said that even as a society such as the Russian, where it is so risky to actually take to the streets, this works, this happens, and that actually ought to inspire us with optimism. Even these societies cannot be completely controlled. That is not a normative statement, but an empirical one. Maybe, if I may, I would like to ask Mr. McEwan on that, because it is indeed something that we see in Britain right now, financial capital, for example, asking the question whether BBC ought to be supported by finances, lies that a prime minister bandies about quite freely. How do you see that, defending actually this fact that discourse is an open-ended process and that due to the economy being so concentrated and financing being so concentrated, there is not that much of this open discourse. Mr. McEwan.
Well, we do face a very difficult problem, but I mean, to take the largest and longest view, in 2 or 3 years' time, we will have an election. We have the opportunity of an election. So, I mean, at some baseline, we must not forget what we've got. And it could be another landslide for the current prime minister, or things could turn on their head. I think my guess would be we're going to go through a great deal of economic hardship. We were already facing massive inflation. Real wages in real terms are falling everywhere across the country. So any incumbent is going to have a very hard time. Now, on top of this, we are going to have to bear some pain of the sanctions. But, you know, our government, I guess if you were on the far right of politics, you would say there must be a God, because just when our prime minister was on the edge of resignation in the face of party going during the time of COVID, along comes a war, and out comes the Churchillian rhetoric. And I have to say, I must concede at the same time, the government has been pretty good on supplying arms to, very good, in fact, on supplying so-called defensive arms to Ukraine. And the British Army has trained 22,000 regular Ukrainian soldiers. So the stuff that we can put abroad, always useful to a prime minister or a president in trouble, anything you can do abroad is always extremely helpful. But we have faced genuine threats to the institutions of democracy, and a slight echo of what's happening in Poland, what's happening in Hungary, we find is happening in the UK. The Supreme Court is in the sight lines of this government. We had a scandal of an illegal proroguing, suspension of Parliament last year. A heroic rebuke from our Supreme Court by Lady Hale. You might notice around the place, if you're in London, a number of women are wearing spider brooches. Those are very meaningful. And my wife bought 30 of them. They cost £2 each, and hands them to her most cherished friends. So there is a fight back, but we're vulnerable when those major institutions of soft power like the BBC are under constant attack. There's a good pushback. There is a big pushback in popular terms. So it's difficult. I think we're on a knife edge. I think the outcomes still depend finally, and thank goodness, on an open election, which in Britain at least, not in the United States, but in Britain at least, the process of its fairness is never in doubt.
Vielen Dank. Ute Frevert hatte sich noch gemeldet, und dann würde ich gerne die Auseinandersetzung zwischen den liberalen Demokratien.
Thank you very much. Then perhaps we ought to come back to turn away from this rivalry between open societies and liberal democracies in Russia, and perhaps look at our own societies. We, as Ivan Krastev quite rightly said, you have to know your own before you give advice to others.
Zum Abschluss dieses Blocks Thank doch you. Noch mal to conclude den Begriff this der Nation eingehen
subject matter, I would like to come back to the term of nation and of national independence, because I believe that that is basically what is at stake right now in Ukraine, and that this is what the people there are fighting for, whether this means national independence with or without, or with how much or how little democracy is, as I
perceive it and as I perceive the situation on the ground of secondary importance. Basically, what is at stake here is the right of a nation to determine its fate and the way in which people want to live. This is something that we have come to know very well from our own histories. Look back to
the present point of view,
the French much more democratic political approach may have come to Germany 200 years ago, although many Germans or rather Prussians at the time would have lived under a French more liberal government at the time. They nevertheless committed themselves to a fight for national independence. So that is something that we must not underestimate, and it's important. Now, as far as Mr. Putin is concerned, his policy is based on this concept of national identity. From the Russian point of view, this is indeed an imperial identity. I don't think, as Ivan Krastev put it, that he has not been clear about this with respect to his elites or his immediate environment. The publications which we've all referred to all go in that very same direction, to give a sense of confidence back to the Russian nation that was negatively affected by the loss of power in 1991 and 1992, and that resulted from that loss of power. Now, no matter what the cause was, but basically he refers to the West being the country or the party to be blamed. It's something that they felt as a personal taunt. The Russian nation has no positive sense of self-confidence, and this imperial recolonization policy has exactly that purpose, to restore that sense of national pride, however you want to call it, and to anchor it. Although there may be people who do not believe this, it meets with or falls on open ears amongst vast swaths of society, because they haven't got much else to take pride in. So that is why I believe that we cannot expect too much resistance against this policy from inside Russia, because it's been explained very well, and the actions have been justified very well to the people. That is a point I'd like to make and ask you to bear at the back of your mind. Despite the fact that there's been a high degree of Europeanization, and despite the fact that we take pride in the Western world at the cohesion and the sense of unity that we find within the European world, in this part of Europe at least, in this part of the world, also in other parts of Europe, of course. As I said, let's not overlook this fact. Let's not forget that nations as a concept is still a vessel that is central for the sense of identity for many people. In a way, I'm contradicting what other people have said. I'm also speaking against my own hopes and wishes, because I have never valued that sense of national belonging or belonging to a particular nation as much as that. But when we look at many of the culture infighting and struggles that take place in our own countries, they are linked to that crumbling sense of belonging to something or somewhere. And although I very much support what Ian McEwan said when he first took the floor, I have to disagree. I don't think that the problems with democracy are only to be traced back to the fact that wealth has been spread in an unfair manner. The people on the right wing of the spectrum take to the streets, and those people do generally not tend to be those parties or people that have lost out and have not received their share of the wealth. They have a general feeling of resentment about the fact that they are being described as people that are deplorable, or might even themselves feel deplorable. But in a way, they are appealing to society at large, including the elites. to reflect about that sense of being described as being a deplorable group or section of society. So that should not be neglected as we look at this subject in general. Thank you. The debate about democracy and the present state of democracy did not begin with the outbreak of the war. We had that debate at earlier points in time. As Armin Nassehi said in a side remark earlier, once in a while, democracies also are unhappy about their openness. This is something we focused on years ago. If I may, I'd like to perhaps pose two, three questions with regard to the situation in our societies right now. Thea Dorn, Ms. Dorn, have we lost something over the last few years? My observation, rather my impression, is that we seem to be increasingly less able to tolerate tensions and to accept open debates and discussions. And a second question, so as to allow others to already think a little bit about what they want to say in response. Is this also to do with the fact that societies have changed dramatically as a consequence of the process of secularization? That in a way, institutions that serve as intermediaries are not there, that at least not institutions that would have the authority of religious bodies and institutions, which in a way has been cushioning the blows on such internal conflicts. Or to put it differently, conflicts of interest these days, expectations with respect to economic prosperity, meet each other perhaps in a much harsher way than or fashion than they used to do in the early years after the Second World War in Germany and in Austria. These are just, you know, thoughts I have, attempts to try to understand, but I'd appreciate your take on this and a more analytical view or look on our societies. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. President. I'd really like to take up the first point you made. I do fully understand, I very much understand the desire to take a very clear moral position, especially under the present circumstances. To be very outspoken is what people have been calling for years now, that you identify what's good and what is bad. I do understand the trend. At the same time, it scares me. It scares me terribly. Earlier, mention was made of people heaving a sigh of relief, and I do understand what was meant by that, but I think that hits the problem on its head. You said in your speech, dictatorship only knows followers or enemies. Don't we witness that kind of trends in the direction of polarizing societies? Don't we also see that reflected these days in the war? But it's something we've been seeing for years now, and it's being fed into and fired up by social media networks. We find it ever more hard to accept that people have a different viewpoint or standpoint. Why can't we just accept what is at the core of a democracy? I believe that to be a justified doubt, which has to be integrated into any society. Where is the red line, so to speak, which is so difficult to define? Where is a justifiable expression of doubt no longer justifiable or acceptable? The strength of democracy is what makes it so difficult. The very moment we want to fulfill our yearning for clarity, this is what is good, this is what is bad, black and white. If we want to make that the dominant element, we lose what is at the same time so important for democracy, because we no longer stand up for openness, we no longer stand up for diversity against the perfidious charm of the autocratic power, you know, which makes it easy to identify what is good and what is bad. bad. We're all happy if we have clarity in our minds. This is the evil empire, and over there are the good rebels. It is an enormous eternal yearning that people have felt in the fight for the light and against the darkness, but we must not give in to that yearning, because otherwise Western democracies will have lost their battle and struggle. On the other hand, you have this, the paradox of fake news. It's not President Trump who invented it. It's an element of postmodern times, of the openness. We experience it in the post-war period, but it has gathered speed probably only over the last few years. Our relationship towards reality expands and extends beyond the world of the social media and has become ever more complex. Let me give you just one or two examples. What kind of discussions do we have within Western societies? For example, about biological gender. Is there something like a biological gender?
Yes.
We don't want to accept that. We say it's far too generalized. It's an outdated description of reality. When you take a look at the academic and scientific discourse, it's very difficult to base on this models to stake out the claim of the scientific world for truth, where we say this is our gold standard for what we believe to be a true statement on reality. In a way, everything is crumbling what we believe to be truth in an emphatic sense of the term. And then you end up have someone who is a fossil in the truest sense of the world. Also, when you look to his thinking, and he, you know, jumps right into the heart of this discourse. If we want to maintain one strength of the Western, we have to avoid stepping out on the dangerous path, treading on the dangerous path that identifies clearly this is good, this is bad. We don't have to think about whether we need a ministry for truth. We don't need that. We are all capable to distinguish what's good, what's wrong, what's good and what's false, right and false. And I think that because human beings tend to be so complicated, this cuts both ways. A wonderful book has been published on this. We will get to that, says the federal president. Do we really want this to happen? I think we have to consider this an opportunity not to drift off into the battle between good and bad, but to stop being so irritated about the fact that we're so complicated and realizing what it is at the core. It is the core of civilization and the core of what makes the heart of an open society. The complexity an advantage, so to speak, says the president. That is perhaps what I would like to add. Yes, yes, of course, you're very right to make that point, and that is why people like us are here at this table, and we have to speak out and to stand up for this, having to impart upon to people and explain to people that this is part of our society. It's not a danger. It's at the core of our civilization. I've been making that point for years. We must not give in to this urge to polarize matters. For the very first time, it's so difficult now, because it's so clear where the good guys are, where the bad guys are. Nevertheless, we must not fall into that trap.
Maren Urner,
perhaps you would like to take up this question of whether we've lost something. What does ambivalence, what makes it so difficult for us to accept ambivalence and complexity in society? Yes, I was getting increasingly nervous because I've got a kind of graph here on my paper. I'll try to give you a kind of scientific analysis in a few sentences. I begin with the contradiction. Begin with a contradiction to what you've just said, Mr. Steinmeier, and that is that complexity is an advantage, is so difficult. It is really very difficult. We have to develop a new narrative for that in order to be able to do so. We have to tell us a new story. And this brings me to my three components. Three is always good for the brain of man and women. And the first component is thinking in groups. We all have a yearning to belong, to belong to a particular group. And many of you pointed to the fact region, nation, certain conceptions and values. What does success mean? What does success of an economy mean? What is a healthy, successful life? What does it mean? This yearning to belong is innate to the human being. And then all of a sudden, we are feeling a sense of fear. We are feeling fear. And I think fear is a very bad advisor. And people tend to do horrible things out of a sense of fear. The second element that we all bear in us, that is innate, apart from this yearning to belong to a group, are habits. Habits are part and parcel of this. The way in which we have structured ourselves as a society, our economic approaches, the meaning of wealth, the meaning of opportunity, to call these conceptions and concepts into question. What do we understand by benefiting from something? And how can we succeed to redraw the limits of certain groups, to redefine certain groups? And a very dangerous point, a very optimistic point of view, will we succeed at a given point in time to tackle the climate change and this challenging circumstances that were man-made, that we have created ourselves, and to see this as a common enemy, which brings me back to this concept of having heroes in our times. Of course, we need these new narratives. As I said, habits, groups, narratives. The narrative, the stories we have to tell ourselves, is that we do share common values that determine our lives, which brings me back to the seeming contradiction. They are part and parcel of our lives. Complexity is something that we have to celebrate, that we have to welcome with open arms. We have to maintain a sense of curiosity in order to understand this overarching concept. Not only that we're capable of flying to the moon and building smartphones, but also accept us as complex societies. Thank you, Christoph Möllers, and then Mr. Jüvers. Christoph Möllers, we the lawyers. We as lawyers and legal experts grew up with that wonderful saying by Mr. Böckenförde that the constitutional state lives on preconditions that it is not capable of providing for itself nor creating itself or finds already in place.
And
that its stability is built on.
Ist von diesen Voraussetzungen etwas verloren gegangen?
Have we lost
something?
Have we lost some of these preconditions? Are we no longer sufficiently capable to recreate them in line with the demands of the times? Well, I've never found that a convincing remark or statement. You have stable monarchy, then a risky democracy. Monarchy is on a firm foundation, and all of a sudden, democracy appears, and it's not very well based, not very well founded. I've never found that plausible in historical terms, and I wouldn't say that when I look to Germany's history, the history of the Federal Republic. I think we have been able to stabilize our republic quite well. It's not quite clear how this was to be understood. The contributions towards stabilization are not necessarily always democratic in nature. It's not always been the ideal of an open society. And then we do experience conflicts. When I read the history of the years of the 1968, that was quite a robust way of tackling things. It was only in the 80s that people were used to a period of calm. And that extended then a bit. And then all of a sudden we had a rough awakening. The crisis of democracy as reflected in literature focused on this and said the normal state of affairs is the Federal Republic of 1982. And now we find ourselves in a crisis instead of saying the normal state was have been 1926. So it doesn't look that bad compared to 1926. So the overall context is a bit unclear. We have to make ourselves aware of the fact that we're not in a crisis that we try to solve. This is part and parcel of democracy. We develop this day in, day out, and we have to prepare ourselves for that. Instead of telling our children that the war is going to be over in a year's time, we have to say it will always continue to be difficult. That will always continue to be the case. Children tend to go away from the parents and to separate themselves. My daughter said to me yesterday, it's a good thing thing about war is that we no longer speak about Corona, the coronavirus, yes. But, you know, I simply want to make the point that there will not be a return to the X80s and the false comes. And there will be no return to the 90s when we say the great things lie ahead. In a way, this is going to be a permanent state of affairs. And I would not want to go back to the years of the 80s, that kind of false sense of calm and stability. Yeah, wonderful. You responded immediately already to the question I was trying to ask, that in democracies we tend not to speak enough about crises, not talking about the fact democracy means continuing stabilization efforts. Mr. Faust, I would like to take up what Thea Dorn said. You spoke, you said just what I would have wanted to say, that we do not, in a way, isolate groups in our societies and trends. Hopefully what I'm going to say now is not going to appear impolite. When I listen to both of your speeches, Mr. President, and also to what you said with regard, what you said in your introduction to the book on the future of democracy, the support for the values and ideals that you mentioned, this emphatical support, I'm nevertheless disappointed because in a way it appears to me to be a kind of proclamation of wonderful ideas and conceptions, people living in internal peace on the basis of shared values. Of course, I'm not against that, not at all, but the chapters, the texts in the book are not sufficiently carried by an understanding for those who have turned their backs on these values or who do not show the same degree of enthusiasm or passion as do those people who are extremely successful in their political career or in their professional careers on a more general basis in our societies. You say, and you said so today, in the book you say that we notice a decreasing sense of trust in democratic institutions. Yes, that's a fact, but shouldn't we, starting at that point in time where we notice this, shouldn't we not try to identify ideologically oriented and driven people who are trying to instigate actions? But shouldn't we not instead ask ourselves, why have people lost their sense of trust in organizations that are meant to represent them? And why is that affecting such a large group of people? And I think, in a way, in Germany, we have this elephant in the room. You know, we speak about migration, about the crisis going back to the year 2015, the influx of refugees at the time we focus on. So, regardless of whether we believe that this is desirable or not, a high level of migration, but it was nevertheless a historic moment where there were but people in favor of us taking in these refugees in our parliament, the Bundestag. Whereas half of the population, I'm giving you a figure now, I don't know whether it's the exact number of people, but roughly half of the population were not in favor. So it cannot be that 100% of our members of parliament are in favor, whereas 50% of the population are against this approach, not only against this, but are in strong opposition to such an approach. Something has to happen, I believe, under these circumstances. You know, channels will be found because we are democracies. The same is true for this debate about whether you get vaccinated or not. However irrational it might appear to you, couldn't you just as easily say that this is an expression of a dramatic decrease of trust in scientific expertise? And you cannot counter this or work against it by saying that scientific experts are so brilliant. Shouldn't we perhaps also start thinking about what view of a university's role lies at the basis of someone being so against getting being vaccinated? What kind of understanding of the scientific world is there? And just briefly, with respect to the foreign policy aspect, in the introduction to this book, you write, Mr. President, democracy is not an instrument of power of the West. And I find that difficult. I think it should have said or read, is not only or not simply an instrument of power, but to say it is no instrument. I think this is not true when you look back to the history of American foreign policy. Susan Neiman said something along those lines. I have to reject that sentence. Of course, in the history of American foreign policy, it's always, democracy has always been a kind of ideological facade for intentions that were hidden, that went in a different direction, or can be, democracy could be in a way put on the back burner if other interests of the government were more important. So if you make statements like this, I don't have to, you know, give you further examples. But these articles, these publications would benefit enormously if they were not so self-satisfied in announcing truths, but if they were to be based on a sense of self-criticism, leading at the end to the realization that, grant you that, despite these violations against the values we have defined for ourselves, and so on and so forth, that they are important for democracies to be able to defend themselves. And to come to the topic of Russia. What we're talking about is a contrast between peaceful Europe and the bad guy Russia, the aggressive approach Russia. But why should Russian foreign policy orient itself mainly along European approaches? They are focusing much more on the United States of America, also when you look to Ukraine. So it is not necessarily completely irrational to think and speak about the role of Ukraine in American foreign policy, and to think hard about this as an element of a global struggle for power. Many of these illusions we have had melt in the sun. Whoever had the illusion that there would never be a war on this face of our earth? I mean, I'm tremendously delighted about this enormous peaceful project that Europe constitutes or embodies. But, you know, we've all been aware of the fact that this is not an island, but that it is important and decisive whether the principles that are being upheld in Europe and that have led to a stable peace can be expanded and extended to countries outside Europe and people outside the Europeans, and whether the Europeans do always, you know, stand by these and have always stood by these principles and values. So, as I said, that is what is at the core of my heart, what I take so close to heart, you know. And we have to think about this, because otherwise, one part of what we're trying to say, we must not think in categories of enemies and friends. We have to be fair, which is the most important commandment here. Openness, a sense of openness towards other, the opinion of others. But then at the same time we say, but unfortunately we're surrounded by enemies, enemies of democracy. And they are our enemies. And we can use the concept of enemies to describe them. In a way, we are there bartering our glorifying our own concept of good guys and bad guys. And perhaps to conclude, I've always thought that Christianity, which is in the gospel, reflected in the gospel, you should try to understand your friends. Not necessarily love, that might take it too far, but in a way that is what embodies this to me. And I do not know whether this kind of understanding is really that widespread and imparted to people.
Man hat sich bemüht, will ich mal.
At least people tried, I think. We've tried Buyx, to do so. Miss Buyx.
Herr Joas hat die Brücke eigentlich schon geschlagen zur Wissenschaft.
Joas tried to build a bridge to the world of science. Perhaps I can add,
war das eigentlich wirklich so, dass die Wissenschaft von Anfang an kritisch really, betrachtet worden ist?
Been viewed in a critical manner in this these years of the pandemic, I saw a view of the scientific community. I think we talked about this earlier, taken by the majority of the people who were really relieved that after these struggles in politics, there finally was a sphere, a place where people knew what was right and what was wrong. The world of science, for a couple of months perhaps, people expected of these people that they were the ones who were to chart the way out of the pandemic for us and that they would be clear about it. Then, observing what was happening, I might be right or wrong in that, there was a second phase, which I could perhaps describe by saying the phase of disappointment, because people had to realize that in the world of science too, people make hypotheses and also fight about what is the right interpretation and the right measure or the right legal approach to take. In a way, it was an up and down process. Did you see that reflection? Did you notice that too? And above all, what does this mean now with respect to the task of transformation that we have to tackle nowadays? When I think for the movement Fridays for Future, they say follow the path of science, follow the scientists. Thank you, Mr. President. If I may, I'd like to just make a brief presentation in order to respond to this question, because I simply have to come back to what Mrs. Dorn said before I respond to your question. Frau Unner said always use 3 points because people can remember that well. I'll try to follow her example. Mrs. Dorn, you made important points. The concern that people had at this point in time is that it sounds so ahistoric, but that we in a way into a trap, the trap of moralizing. It is tempting, but it is wrong. I'm summarizing this very much, but leads us to a sense of carelessness and where people do not care about anything, that they reinterpret things, and that sense of everything being subject to discussion. And this brings me to my actual point, the problem that I see, that there is nothing, I think someone mentioned it earlier, nothing like shared values or a shared interpretation of what good life means. So no one is in a position to say this is good and this is wrong. This is difficult, and I'd like to link this to the situation in which we find ourselves, because neither the one nor the other helps us in this particular situation. Thank you, Mrs. Orner, for highlighting that we need a third way. Other people have said that on different occasions. We must not give in to simply moralizing, nor should we give in to an approach that says everything is open to discussion. But what we have to do instead, and that is the third way, identify corridors in which harsh questions of right and wrong and sometimes also good and bad are being discussed, because we have to defend liberal democracy. And we have highlighted many different nuances of this and dimensions of this. We spoke about power political issues. Herr Merkel said that, Frau Göpel hinted at this, and I trust we will probably take this up to the infrastructure aspect of defending democracy. Energy is a very important topic. The critical infrastructure, the fact that our digital infrastructure, which is of critical importance, has to be defended at the end of the day, the concept of cyber warfare and so on and so forth. And then the main point I'd like to make, defending societies in a democracy. This third way has to celebrate complexity, Mrs. Urner, but complexity in itself is at risk, which brings me now to a reformulation of what Mr. Birkenfelder said. The preconditions for a beneficial tackling of a complexity, once they're being destroyed, we have to make this a topic, which brings me back to the very beginning of our discussion. What we are witnessing are attacks on this kind of debate, on this type of debate, which cannot be stopped by us saying we must not draw any red lines here. We generally have that freedom of opinion, which is one of the tenets and one of our main achievements. But this does not mean we have not and should not stand up to false information, to fake news, to propaganda. Herr Kehlmann, you referred to what you've seen on YouTube. This has been prepared for years and years. It's part and parcel of a kind of warfare that started way back 10 years, a minimum 10 years ago. These different narratives that are being spread and where also people try to make sure that vast swaths of society had access to that kind of information. You see these public statements, these that are, and that is quite obvious, fed by false news, which makes it imperative for us to defend democracy. Ms. Dorn, you did not make this point, so please don't take offense, but this is why we must not simply say it's not possible to define this is good, this is bad, postmodern approach isn't good either, so that is it. What we have to do is to face up to this task, define those corridors, and to make good use of them, which brings me now to your question, Mr. President. I'd like to respond to it, because being a scientist, this is what we've experienced. The first stage, which was way too easy, these scientists, they will tell us, they're not the scientists. Scientists thrive on us engaging in discussion, shaping consensus, working with new realizations and new data, and that we challenge each other on a continuous basis, and that this is a continuing learning process. But that was the first phase. And then the second phase, people were disillusioned, said, well, they don't know the way ahead. They don't know what this is all about. So that was a kind of general disillusionment. But scientists have been working hard, trying to point out that this dynamic change, this third way, is what can be expected of the world of science and of scientists. However, this does not mean that one can not draw red lines within this or along this third path. We have to defend it. We have to defend ourselves when scientists are being attacked. We have to stand up and defend, because it's part of a liberal democracy that the world of science and scientists are being discredited in a general manner. This process of taking one step ahead and going one step back, this openness towards other opinions, it has to be defended that that is the approach and not a problem, that that is the way in which people develop their knowledge and their expertise. And it has to be defended without the basis being pulled, the rug being pulled from under the feet of the scientists, which we are experiencing these days. And things in Germany are still very mild in their development. But you see this in other contexts. You see it in the latest development in Ukraine, in systems where autocratic regimes are in power, that the world of science and the scientists are being attacked, and that this kind of discourse is no longer protected, which brings me to my final point. With regard to the major tasks of transformation, because you pointed to that, that lie ahead, that focus, for example, on the energy supply security, how do we tackle when, say, in 6 months' time, the people in our countries
sehr stark vor Augen stehen, die hohen Energiepreise,
are aware of the fact that energy prices are very high, when we have come to the point where we feel the socio-economic effect of the sanctions and the wars, and the war here in Germany, when the internet does what it also does, and that is not only making possible for people to form an opinion, but also to provide fake news and disinformation and carry that into societies. Then the moment has come for the academic and the scientific world. They will try to find solutions. That is what scientists are for, to submit proposals for the transformation of the energy sector. How can we become more independent? How can we be more sustainable? It can be viewed as an opportunity, a genuine opportunity, as an option for an approach. How can we ensure that we strengthen resilience in our society so that people can even manage to get through such a phase where they are much worse off. Something we will then have to suffer in our daily life. However, we can only do that when people, when we do not have to fear that attacks on the world of science, campaigns waged against institutions or subjects of the world of science are also being lumped into that heading, we must be open and leave room for general discussion and rejection. We, I believe, have to be clearer, and we have to say we can say what we want, and we also have to say what we do not want. I think we should be more courageous, and I'm speaking as a scientist, speaking about the world of science, but I think it's also true for other areas of societies and sectors of society.
Thank you very much. I'm looking to Mr. Holstein, and I know there's somebody in the room who has not only experienced attacks via social media, but who's been actually first personally attacked. So where are the red lines within a society? How do we defend ourselves against such attacks? But let me perhaps move over to the arguably biggest challenge in Germany and in Europe, this question of a transformation towards a climate-neutral society. Society with all of the consequences that this has, and maybe Bernard Volks can make a comment on this. You wrote about the big irritability, but basically you wrote about this sentence of the daughter of Christoph Möllers, which has an inherent wisdom. The daughter says, thank God the pandemic is over. Why am I saying this? Because we all suspect, we all know, once this big transformational challenge is on our doorstep, then we need to actually muster all of our strength, all of our ability to achieve that. And you were saying that democracies are actually not all that capable of meeting these challenges, at least if we look at the media. There was one issue that dominated all of the headlines, namely, how do we get to climate neutrality, and before that it was the pandemic. And all of a sudden, that has been pushed aside, apart from because there's now this war. Can we actually, and nothing else has, there's not room for anything else in the public debate. So is it something that we can actually afford, only concentrating on one big issue and not several ones? And is that not in direct contradiction to complexity? As we mentioned it before. Well, yes, it is. It is, because we have processes of hyper-focus among the media on certain issues. We have fantastic real-time quota. We see immediately how well does a certain headline work, how often is it has it been clicked, how well is a story about a giant squid in a Japanese harbor received by the digital public compared to a new conflict in the Middle East. You look at the real-time quota with which and rates with which this is measured, and you see that, it is, from an economic viewpoint, rather dangerous. But perhaps I should come to the tension that I see inherent in our debate, and that I feel is underlying this debate. I share everyone who praises dissenting opinions, who says there is a real lust for a critical debate, for new opinions, for diverging opinions, for doubt, for skepticism, yes. But on the other hand, this crisis is of a nature, the climate crisis, and certainly also the pandemic, that requires something else from us, namely focusing very quickly, building very quickly a consensus, acting very fast, ideally on a global scale. And this tension, at least as I see it, doesn't seem to be really dissolved. how long can you actually afford to waste time on discourse against the background of a rapidly developing crisis scenario of a global scale? How long can you actually have a media infrastructure that does one thing beyond any doubt, namely send the wrong kinds of signals that lead always to actually discriminating against consensus? This impossibility, to put it that way, to very quickly focus on something to build consensus, to also concentrate, is something that I am deeply worried about, because this impossibility, in a way, has a lot to do with the way that our media are built. Yes, of course, you cannot, for example, say RT Germany can be banned. It would be simply not acceptable to have them bandy about their war propaganda. But there is a almost tectonic shift here in the direction of polarization. This postmodern philosophy, in many ways, has become a gruesome reality in our media. So what do we do? Well, as I see it, in this type of crisis that we need to contend with right now, in the fact that we have very little time to do so, the fact that we need to be open-minded, to be skeptical, to allow for dissenting views, that brings us to the question for which we have not yet found a definitive answer. How can we respond to this media revolution that has brought about a situation where we obviously have to celebrate dissenting views, openness, but where at the same time, we avoid these wrong kinds of signals? And that means let us build a media that is somehow different, because we cannot grapple with each other in a media arena and develop all the time better possibilities of debating with each other, and do this in an environment that is so much structured by clicks, by overheating, by creating excitement. There are three big winners of the pandemic. In 2021, 46 revenue of advertising ads went to Amazon, Google, and Meta, Facebook. Now, this year, they will probably crack the 50% ceiling. So we have a cannibalization of the publishing market, of advertising, and so a loss of informational infrastructure within our liberal democracies, which from a political and systemic point of view requires a resolute reaction. Otherwise, we lose this infrastructure, and we have to really contend with this. We really have to face this. Otherwise, we're left with nothing. Thank you very much for this optimistic view of the current situation, says the President. Ms. Göpel, will politicians be able to achieve this transformation? Well, from a scientific point of view, the answer would be depends. Depends on what? I'd like to yet again talk about complexity, because I think that too is an oscillating kind of term. Complexity, yes, inviting people more, being more aware of other dissenting opinions, yet at the same time we can only act once we have reduced complexity. So let me come back to what Zulks has said. The scientific method, how has it faced this? And methodology, trying to grapple with this problem of it is necessary to reduce complexity.
sich klar zu machen, dass
I think it's most important to be clear that obviously I approach reality in a different way from a scientific point of view rather than doing it from my own individual moral point of view. It's always sort of a tightrope act, and I'm not saying automatically science is objective, but choosing is a very conscious process if I take the scientific method seriously. So I think as a scientific community ought to contribute in such a way that they say we try to structure this process, and this in a most transparent way. And that goes beyond my own impulses, my own moral persuasion. So it's important that the plurality of scientific methods is sufficient, is sort of shown in a sufficiently broad basis. I think that it's most important to concentrate on certain important. If I'm looking at modeling certain trends, and then in the end, CO2 emissions have become a very relevant sort of component, then I need this on the basis for the basis of developing countermeasures. I think we ought to be very careful not to take too narrow a view and then sort of perhaps explaining this as to the rest of the world as a gospel truth. So we have to look at larger trends, we have to model them so that corridors are identified. I think that's a very important term. But creativity, all of that that allows us to be open-minded, that is also something that we should not lose in the process of looking at individual little nodules. Now, the difference between a scientific view, physics, chemistry, and so on, and then limits to the freedom of the individual in the face of this crisis, there too obviously is a tension, and that is something that we need to differentiate. We in the Scientists for Future community are grappling very much with this. How can we see to it that social sciences are also working according to a certain methodology, even though they may not be as reliable as natural sciences. Maybe they have different reliabilities than natural sciences. Well, but coming back to democracy, we have to be clear what are the instruments with which I have faced reality. That is something that the scientific community is trying to do, and I think it ought to be more transparent of this process. Why have I chosen a certain instrument, and how does that lead me to certain recommendations or to certain sort of sortings, if you like, of the complexities of the day. But in the beginning, there have been difficulties with that. But for example, Mr. Drosten is a good case in point. He always then later on tried to explain how he arrived at certain discoveries. And if we see more of science as a method, I think we shouldn't say this is the future of democracy, and this is just the right kind of democracy, and bang people over the head with it. But saying this is a scientific method that has proved itself in allowing for certain possibilities of participation in taking decisions or in influencing decisions in this ever-changing world that seem right for me, for my situation. And in a nation state, in this, not in between nation states, but in these new structures, with these new spheres of influence, how can, within this complex system, how can I try and strengthen these methods for finding the right kind of balance to bring about democratic decisions, and at which level, for example, with the European level, as we now see, is very important with many of the big issues. There are other issues for which the global level is important. Then again, there are decisions which we seem to de-regionalize again. So this resilience in the way that it was understood here, I think, is most important. Not trying to defend ourselves against certain structures, but asking ourselves what should remain resilient. And there are two things that are most important here: individuals and what guarantees the survival of the individual, the environment, our ecosystems, whatever. With biological beings, that is a precondition. And then, obviously, security of supply. And I think, to take up what Maren said, absence of fear has a lot to do with trusting in being able to get supplies the very next day for myself. And also the promise of a social market economy coupled with a democratic society where the common weal is part of the normative orientation of the system itself. So questions on the climate, on energy, tackling those means that, in a way, we almost have to change our currency in the sense that resource fairness of access to resources is most important. That's what the Federal Constitutional Court said. They changed the currency. They said this is not about trying to buy yourself off by sort of compensating for the CO2 emissions. But the budget is the CO2. The budget of CO2 needs to be distributed fairly and squarely, not to only today, but for future generations. So that also comes to energy supply. We need to talk about kilojoule. That's what's interesting for people. Who is going to receive what by way of energy supplies? So what does energy supply actually mean? What is the convincing message to the rest of the world? I think we see this in similar ways as regards access to housing. It's a very central issue for our society. But in the financial markets, we're talking about a huge concentration of money because the people who have real estate are reaping extraordinary revenues. And that certainly isn't fair. So what kind of currency do we allot to this? We've seen this in our financial markets. And so we have to generate trust again. We have to prove to people that we're up to it and then say to them, we believe in a common social solution. We see the crises. We have to be trustful that there is going to be a collective answer to that which leaves no one behind. And this is not the case right now, because in many crises, after a first solidarity that was shown very short term, it was lost. That was Corona. That was the pandemic. A lot of solidarity, people abided by the rules, and then all of a sudden people said, oh, but these companies or this organization that's better organized, they are receiving a lot of money by way of compensation, whereas the arts world, for example, didn't. They were left out. So an inclusive process, a democratic process, that is what we need to do, and that builds trust. People are not left behind. Thank you. It was very, very great interest that I listened to you today, and it is indeed an issue that is relevant to all of us, but obviously an issue also that to a fairly large degree also has an impact on our business community. And, you know, I am leading a global media company. So from my vantage point, on the one hand, I believe that we need to build a common structure of shared values to which we all feel committed. And we have to also remember that we have to talk to our people, that we must not leave them behind. If I talk to my people, they have to understand in my company what actually is the general goal of our company. I have to take them along. I have to convince them. And that is basically what this is all about. People are afraid in this overall environment right now. many of them are not able to understand modern technology, surprisingly enough. And many of them, they are not able to understand this. A lot of people have been taken along and have to be taken on board who are simply unable to look after themselves. Then education. Education is something that we need to understand in such a way that very, very early on, young children of 8 or 9 years of age are inundated with information. I talked about this before with our president. These days, a young girl of 12 is considered a teenager, whereas we, in my day, lived a very sheltered life. As a child. So the overall society, our social systems are undergoing profound changes. And where they will end up in 10 years' time, I think no one around this table is able of telling us. At least there would be different answers to it, I think. Yes, but I mean, that's why we debate these issues. We will certainly need our scholars and scientists. Without them, we will simply not be able to do this. But we also need an interplay of political, social and scientific stakeholders. Without our business community, we will not be able also to get out of this. And we have to be very fast right now. If I look at Bertelsmann of the past 3 years, our corporation has changed completely, and for the management, for our staff, this was an enormous effort, shouldering with this responsibility. And our health, obviously, is an issue. There is a huge burden placed on our health system, and here too we have to be very careful that those who are at the very top are able to survive this. I always say that being in a job is certainly a marathon, and it's also obviously even more difficult for people who lead companies. What I'm trying to say to the members of my management, to the members of my staff, is that they should look after themselves, they should be mindful of their own health, they should learn, they should... Life will be characterized by a process of learning. We need our most brilliant minds, take them together, assemble them around a table, because each and everyone on his or her own will simply not be able to contend with all of these different challenges. I think countries have to be capable also to live democracy. It's like in a company, when you don't understand what's going on, how on earth are you expected to know what you need to build a democracy or to build and lead a company? A peaceful world in all of the countries all over the world is something that we will probably never see. There will always be conflicts erupting here and there in some corner of the world. But what we're experiencing right now is something that, I would not have dreamt of seeing that again. I was a child towards the end of the Second World War. We took refuge in an air raid shelter, and it's a clarion call. It is waking us up. We lived through this century where we thought peace was eternal, and now it is most important that from all walks of life, from all of the different strata of society, we bring people together and try to reach out to people and try to make them understand what's happening, because that is the only guarantee for our collective success in a society. Thank you. Thank you, says the President. That is quite a pessimistic view, saying that we will probably not see a world where peace reigns all over, but at least we can do our best to prevent lack of peace from gaining ground too much. I'm still optimistic that there are sufficient people who will try to work for peace. On transformation, I was talking about the capacity of democracy to process these changes. I think that on the road towards climate neutrality, we have to work in a triangle that is very ambitious and very challenging. We need, obviously, ambitious climate goals, climate targets. We, at the same time, have to, and that's something that each and every government will have to do, we have to generate economic growth, which enables us to pay for these innovations. And third, we mustn't lose sight of the social balance. That is this very challenging triangle with which we have to contend with for the next decades to come. And I wonder whether our democracies will be capable of doing this, will prevail. And let me, and transformation, and I mean this independently of ecological transformation, transformation will only ever be successful when the weaker links of society also see that there's a benefit for them in this. If we are not mindful of this, we will fail with our transformation. On the issue that Alexander Van der Bellen underlined, where are the red lines within a society? We talked about openness, but openness also needs some kind of common reference framework where we meet as equals, where we meet as those who are part of the democratic process. And these, this commons, if you like, has been shrinking, and I talked about this in public. We see that this warm fire around which we congregated during my youth, and that was our Tagesschau, the national news, that this is no longer all that relevant for many people. So there are people congregate around different sources of media. But one thing remains important that Alexander Van der Bellen very much underlined. Even with all of the technological advances at our disposal, there are certain basic red lines that we must not cross. Where are these basic red lines? And as a society that guarantees freedom of opinion, freedom of the press, open-mindedness, do we remain credible when we draw these red lines? Well, I did address Andreas Holstein a little earlier, where he said, who was attacked by somebody who wielded a knife at him, and that showed the great irritability existing in our society, the anger that individuals have shown. And these individual cases, and each and every individual case is one too many, is something that we also need to recognize. You, I think, said that the social media are the new artillery of democracy. I don't know whether that sentence comes from you, but the social media have a role that obviously have a lot of advantages. Sometimes they support many of you around this table, but they also have inherent risks, and that is something that was well documented by many of you. Ms. Stein, the role of the social media in a changed public commons and public debate. I cannot actually remember saying this sentence of the social media being the artillery, but the social media obviously empower a society in the sense that a society can articulate and voice its views in a way that in previous times was only possible for journalists or for the elites.
An das Bild anzuknüpfen, and was to Daniel Kehlmann anfangs gebracht hat.
Man schaut come back to Daniel Kehlmann's remarks in the beginning. You look at the algorithm and then you see of how reality changes as a consequence because of what was transmitted via YouTube. I've been thinking right now, we have actually a key position to develop. We would have to work extremely hard to enlighten people, but the problem is that doesn't seem to be sufficient because we don't reach people. As Ms. Mohn said, we need to reach out to people. That exactly is what has changed so much for us journalists. In previous times, we were able to broadcast something, we were able to write something, and it was received. Now the situation is that we have to reach out to those partial public domain, to this fractured public domain, and sometimes these people can no longer be reached. There are filter bubbles, that simply don't believe us. They would never believe what we are saying. What we're saying around this table is smart, is intelligent, is wise, but what actually reaches those people whom we need to convince? So that's the challenge for the media. We have to change. We have to change our approach. We have to change the way we work. That's one of the consequences of the impact of social media and of these changes. I think these changes can actually be identified quite clearly. This is about diversity. And this diversity can strengthen democracy. And that does not only have something to do with where people actually come from, these people that are journalists, that are parts of the media, but also how old are they and what level of education do they have? That's something that this group of people here around this table brought home to me. These are different worlds that we live in and that they live in. And this sounds so trite, but of course, journalists have to change, media have to change. Basically, that's not a particularly dynamic development, if we're very honest. If we look at who is actually writing, who is actually publishing, what sort of mechanisms are these, Mr. Perksen described this very eloquently. Because for many, many years, we've become a migrant society. This is not something that's reflected in the media. So there is a decoupling. We've become a country with East Germany, West Germany, even after so many years. And that, too, is not really clearly reflected in the media. Basically, it's West German media. Obviously, that's a simplification, but still it's true. So we have to be very, very fast in order to keep up with the social media and move in the sphere where they move and reach people, because it's, if possible, just one world, not several worlds. And that's the only thing that can actually strengthen democracy. Thank you very much, and not only through media, but Ms. Della Porta.
It is not an easy question to address, and of course there are many words that comes as words of related with the red line. One is racism, one is machism, one is exclusions in general. But I think that what we have to reflect upon when we think about the future of democracy is also that those conditions that you were talking about are changing. So there is no way out of adapting institutions. We need innovations, transformations also in the democratic institutions, but we need also institution building. So it is not that any type of participation is good. It is not that any type of openings is good, but we need to reflect upon which type of reforms we should introduce, because I think that we have been talking about Western democracies and liberal democracy. It is fine. I mean, it is things we have to reflect upon, but they are not enough, because when we think about Western democracy, we automatically exclude from our conceptions people that are with us. So I was reflecting about this morning, coming by taxi with an Iranian taxi driver. Of course, as a Berliner and a taxi driver, he was immediately asking me, why was I going to Bellevue? And I said, talking at a conference, and he said, about what future of democracy, how does it look like? And I said, well, it doesn't look very, very well, but I think we will overcome the crisis. And I asked him which type of botschaft you would have for our discussions. And he said,
That was his question?
And the question she said is about the conceptions of the human rights. He said, if Western democracy, we have to think about coherence. So the fact that when we deal with international relations, we don't have to deal differently with different types of Flüchtlingen, for instance, asylum seekers. He said we are in solidarity with Ukrainians, but we also have in our societies other types of people that need help. And what he said was also, and I think this is something to reflect upon, we need to also think in terms of how to convince the others, so not only to strengthen ourselves. And I think this is coherent with the type of discussions that we are having about how to adapt our institutions to the permanent crisis that we are living in. So we live, we have used words today like crisis a lot. We are living in complexity and contingencies that increase the need to intervene. And I think that when we say liberal and when we say Western, we still have a lot of work to do in order to say which types of democracy. Mm-hmm. And the changing conditions, which I think are there, they represent at the same times challenges, but also opportunities. So Van der Bellen said, without the social media, the political history of Austria would have been different in recent years. We know that also challenges in terms of the debate on science and so on are to a certain extent related with the growing possibilities of education. So it is at the same time an opportunity, but also a challenge. Politicization that is happening a lot on many areas is also potentially good for democracy because it means people are interested and want to talk, but it also implies reflecting upon which type of institutions we have to build. So I think that the Rote Linien are there, but especially thinking in terms of the methods, thinking in terms of the process, of the contingencies that you have mentioned, on the how we discuss things that President Van der Bellen has also addressed. I think that we have to go beyond what we have already and experiment with potentials for more participations of the citizens and more deliberations as well.
Alexander, danke.
Just briefly, a few points, if I may, regarding the part played by social media in politics. Recently, there was a series shown on television in Germany. It's called Berlin, Babylon. And I think at a certain point in time, people said there that around 1930 in Berlin,
28 or 32 Tageszeitungen.
There were 28 or 30 daily papers publishing. If that is true, I can only say that the phenomenon of bubbles is nothing new. No one can tell me that a citizen in Berlin is able to look through or to read 15 daily papers. There were papers for the Trotskyists, for the Social Democrats and for the Socialists and for the Catholics, the bourgeois Catholics. So this is nothing new. But then again, it's not a comforting third because we know, thought because we know what it led to and how it ended. And says the president, we're asking ourselves which paper we would have read. Yes, says President von der Bellen. We can talk about that later. What worries me is a certain sense of lethargy amongst politicians. Lethargy to a certain extent is normal, but 50% of the income goes to three American companies. And what does this say about the European market for papers and media? We have to react. Either we have to reduce the profit they make, or we have from ads, or we have to replace the classical, this on the classical market, because otherwise it will continue. The editing departments will become ever smaller, the time to actually carry out decent research becomes ever shorter, and still we will be amazed that the quality is worsening. So we have to stand up to this trend. We have to do something. You mentioned the red lines. For me, it's a very simple matter when we look to Ukraine. Please don't tell anyone, don't share this with anyone, but I was a very serious critic of Ukraine's policy until the end of last year. Over time, I became a bit more moderate, but in my talks with President Poroshenko first and then later with President Zelensky, those exchanges haven't always been very friendly in nature. But then again, that's normal. What is not normal, though, is a military attack on the state. On the territory of a national state. So all the concerns I may have had have become irrelevant. It's clear on what side my sympathies are or with what side my sympathies are. Simply wanted to make that point and leave it with you. I think Ms. Frevert pointed to the part nation, a nation plays these days, or the concept of nation plays these days. I always respond slightly nervously when we talk about this. Russia has waged a long war in the Caucasus, in Chechnya, and this had nothing whatsoever to do with the concept of a nation. There are no Russians there to be found there. It was neither based on strategic ideas nor economic motivations, perhaps with the exception that if we allow them to leave Russia, others will follow suit, and we don't want them to do so. So that is an argument in itself. We don't have to welcome it or to approve of it, but it's an argument, a justification. Now, take Austria. Is that a nation? A topic that has been heatedly debated in my country, I have to say, for a long time. Over the last 30 years or so, the idea actually gained ground that we are an independent nation, the Austrians. Even the former German nationals are seriously engaging in a discussion that would aim to negate that. But what does it mean?
I have a holländischen Namen.
My name is Dutch in origin. My mother used to be Estonian. My father was Russian. I happen to be the federal president of the Republic of Austria. So my parents took care that I became a member of that nation. It's fine by me. I feel very much at ease there. I'm very happy to be there.
Was ist das? Ja, ich habe meine Bedenken, diesen Begriff einfach so zu verwenden, als ob wir wüssten, wovon
concept
wir reden.
Of a nation. We use it as if we knew what it meant. I don't want to go into the history of this term, but we have this interesting discussion about whether the Austrians, those who spoke German or pretended to speak German, and whether the Germans that live in the Federal Republic of Germany, whether they are related in some way, perhaps form one nation. These days we have just agreed in a pragmatic manner to say that we are speaking two nations here. So in sociological terms, in political terms, you know, we say it just so happened somehow. When I met with ambassadors of the member states of the European Union in Vienna, I was once asked to explain Austria to someone. I was taken by surprise.
You should realize Austria is not Germany.
I said, you should realize Austria is not Germany. Sorry.
No hard feelings deswegen.
no hard feelings because of that. Another very popular topic, and it's been a topic for 100 years because we've been sharing, people have asked us, are you speaking the same language? And I say, no, we're writing the same language, but we're not speaking the same language. And things like that, you know, from a sociological perspective, it's incredibly interesting. We can talk about this for hours. We can even struggle about this and fight or be in disagreement on this for hours, but my personal life until now has been the life of an adult. I spent 50% on engaging in research at academic institutions and work for 3.5 years with a BSCP, which was a wonderful period in time, and then for 30 years I was engaging in politics. My impression is that you are expecting too much of politicians and of politics, to some extent. Both of us are non-executive presidents.
Still,
the concerns against the Weimar Constitution haven't gained as much ground in Austria as they did in Germany, so all of a sudden I have surprising tasks to attend to, which make me all of a sudden executive in my functions. So in a way, it's normal that if there is a lack of time, or when there is a lack of time, I don't know who made that point, but somebody made it, that if you're under time pressure, you sometimes have to take difficult decisions, and sometimes you have to take them under a cloud of insecurity because you don't really know the distribution or the kind of impact your decision will have. But you have to decide. You have to take a decision. And at the end of the day, you might have said that it might have been the wrong one, but you have to accept it. And if you can't accept it, you don't belong in the world of politics. And I have to say, I'm sorry. That's the way it is. So I do have great understanding and also a sense of sympathy with genuine executive politicians. For example, the German Chancellor, any prime minister who these days has to tackle three crises at the same time, the pandemic, the climate crisis, and the Ukraine crisis. And what else may be ongoing at the home front? That is their daily bread, their daily business. Fortunately, this kind of crisis and the communication of crisis has not become their daily bread. We've become too lethargic for that. I always try to understand politics on a rational basis. I always ask myself, what does Putin aim for through his actions? But then again, politicians don't always act rationally, and that makes it even more complicated.
Thank you. Thank you.
Is that Karl Kraus who said everything that separates us is the common mother tongue? Nothing separates as much as the common mother tongue. I think that was what he said, Karl Kraus. Perhaps I can only make that remark or make that point. When we meet, the five of us, the five presidents of the German-speaking language, we speak English with each other.
Might seem absurd.
Well, you pointed to the clock. We are 30 minutes behind schedule. So allow me to put but two questions to conclude. The last but one question, or the very last question, concerns the concept of nation. Oh, no, the nation that Western democracies have taken in a way as their guiding line. Perhaps you, Ludwig von Mittler, could perhaps also say something on the relationship between the United States of America and Europe. But the last but one question I would like to address to you and to come back to what you said, Alexander, in your contribution and also refer to the comments made before you, what is being reflected in the media and what is not reflected in the media. Mr. Khorchide, you will probably describe what is not being reflected in the social media or in the media at all. Mr. Khorchide. Perhaps I may just say a word regarding the discussion earlier today. One term that hasn't been directly used, only indirectly, but I nevertheless believe is important for this debate, is the term of identity. It was mentioned earlier more than once that this unequivocalness this ambiguity, intolerance, this painting things in black and white, this pointing the moral finger, this unequivocalness are so important because they provide a sense of identity. And this is why we, in the religious context, and that is my background because I'm a theologian, speak about fundamentalism as a response to this arbitrariness. And this is why we have a problem with this exclusive identity, which is the reaction to postmodern arbitrariness, which brings me to the subject of democracy. I was struck during our discussion today that we are stressing either directly or indirectly that democracy is an exclusive, is a model exclusive to the Western world. It's becoming an identity issue for Europe. For this makes it difficult. I come from the Middle East. It is where I grew up. And I know that the way democracy is received and interpreted there is different. Democracy has an image problem there, because it is associated with the Western world and with the history of colonialism and so on and so forth. So the point I would like to make is that it is important not only to speak about the openness of democracy to outcomes, but of the openness of democracy in the sense that democracy can only be a democracy if it opens. It cannot and must not be exclusive, and it must not lead to the exclusive identity of a continent or a politically exclusive identity. We have to agree on something that is non-negotiable. It doesn't have to be democracy as a model, as a basic model for everyone, but fundamental values, democratic values, with which people identify themselves, not only Europeans, but people in general, all over the world, something that is non-negotiable, an identity that is non-negotiable, and that indeed is unequivocal. And once that is the case, we can speak about openness, which brings me exactly to that question, the question of perception. I spoke a lot to, I engage a lot with Muslim circles. I was interested to hear that Mr. Van der Bellen is an Austrian national and a German national at the same time. I am a refugee, a Palestinian refugee. Actually, it was the Austrian citizenship was the first one granted to me. Before that, I was a stateless in a way. The way in which people perceive democracy, and this is why I'm making this point, I do so on purpose. People in Europe who live with us are part of the European people, so to speak, but they bring their own narrative about democracy with them. The future of democracy can thus not be limited to the European world, us saying we want democracy in Europe, but we speak about democracy in Europe. In a global world, there will only be a future for democracy that we can guarantee if we pursue a global approach instead of pointing the finger at the bad guys and saying we are the good guys, but rather show empathy and concern about the well-being and the welfare of people in the world at large. We want to change things, not because it is in our very own economic interest, but because we are talking non-negotiable principles here that are dear to our hearts. Otherwise, we would be changing paradigms.
In der Weltpolitik, in der Außenpolitik,
also
auch
on the global front and in the field of foreign policy. And in acting that way, we can have the hope that the way in which democracy is perceived in other countries will be more positive. I, as I said, think here especially of the Middle East from which I come. I think there the perception will then change. There is a potential for transformation in that part of the world too.
Ms. Kopetsch, Mr. Holstein,
how can we ensure
in der
that people engage in politics, participate in politics, and I say on purpose in politics because it does not begin at the level of land parliaments or the Bundestag or the National Assembly of Austria. Basically, engagement in politics begins at the local level, and that it becomes increasingly difficult these days to find people who are willing to engage on a regular basis, to meet with a limited budget of time with other people on certain evenings or days during the week and make that amount of time available. It's of course to be traced back to the fact that our working lives have become more complex, but not only, I believe. Perhaps you can give us a feeling or a sense for what can be done at the local level in order to encourage people to participate in the political sphere and to engage at the level where it is perhaps best possible to shape developments and to participate. Do you want me to begin? I wanted to, if I may, come back to the question of Mr. Joas and Ms. Stein, who said, how does it happen that even within the liberal democracies of the Western world and the Nordic countries, how was it possible that a protest movement against democracy has gained a foothold there? And what do we have to say in response in order to avoid to put oneself into positive a position moralizing towards others? This is a social phenomenon because we tend to not have anyone here presenting us with a different opinion in this discussion. As is true for this discussion about the rise of right-wing nationalism, this discourse cannot be separated from people reassuring themselves about their moral values, because this discourse is not something that is being enforced upon you, but the majority of the statements about the right-wing nationalists tend to come from the same circle. So in a way, people are using this discourse in order to reconfirm and reaffirm the value of democracy and to put a seal of approval on that. In my work, I've tried to make the attempt, I undertook the attempt to provide a basis for this debate and discussion. I say we have different positions here, and we have a basis of different positions. On this basis, we can try to understand how it comes that there are different forces here that take different views and that tackle the issue of social injustices. We have grown used to the fact to only reach agreement on protest movements on the left side of the political spectrum. However, this protest movement on the right-wing spectrum might also be traceable or traced back to social injustices. I believe that the threat, that there are two groups that pose a threat to our democracies: the vast group of the people who do no longer vote, the group of people who have withdrawn completely from the political sphere and who no longer believe that the institutions of liberal democracy work in their interests and represent their interests, that do no longer believe that modern democracies contribute towards improving their position. The majority of these people come from underprivileged classes, from the classes of the poor people. So in a way, it's a social issue too. We have to reduce social injustice, and I think this has not been sufficiently mentioned, if we want to allow democracy to flourish, also out of a spirit of social democratic solidarity. And the second group is the heterogeneous group of the right-wing populists and radicalists, the AfD in Germany. And here it's a bit more difficult to link this to the root cause of injustice. It's, as I said, a very heterogeneous group of people, a very heterogeneous movement. On the one hand, they attack, you have underprivileged people from the lower classes that are attracted, but you also have representatives of the middle classes and the upper classes. Look to the AfD, that is a good example. And thus it is much more complicated and difficult here to establish that link to a lower social position. In my work, I tried to use a method or to employ a method that is called the method of theory-guided empathy, trying to explain why we have this rise of the right-wing extremists in Germany. We believe that we have indications that point to a link here, a possible link here to deep structures of our society and the response to the consequences and the impact of globalization. My proposition is that this is an epochal transformation that has started in 1990 as a consequence of globalization. And the reception in some parts of our society, amongst which I count myself, has been a positive reception, a positive response, whereas others find themselves in a position of protest. And what we are losing here is a certain general sense of belonging that we used to have in the post-war period in Germany, of the traditional middle classes, which was normally in the 80s and the 90s and widespread in the 80s and the 90s, but has seemed to be pushed to the fringes, and it is now just an approach or position held by exclusive elitist classes, no longer the traditional middle classes. The values that were characteristic for the former republic, like sincerity, discipline, honesty, loyalty, and also perhaps a certain commitment to a degree of modesty, that has been lost, and a more cosmopolitan approach that is neoliberal in nature or has neoliberal traits has become to the forefront, and other social milieus serve as a fertile ground for these right-wing extremist and nationalist movements. Mr. Holstein, you have a different empirical base. You used to be mayor in the city of Altena in Nordrhein-Westphalia. You made that experience way back, a mayor of whom people thought that he had become part of an elitist class, although he's as close to the grassroots level as hardly anyone else. You're no longer mayor, Mr. Holstein. The more freely can you now provide us with advice? How can we convince young people to actively participate and gain experience with shaping political developments? How can we make them assume responsibility and move away from that corner of facile criticism without engaging? I believe that that, in a way, is the red thread, the thread of our discussion today. How can we make people, young people show passion for politics? You have to be passionate about it, otherwise you cannot do a job like mine. You know, I once stood as a Lord Mayor and did not win. I can live with that. I submitted an offer to people. They rejected it, but I don't think that many people these days submit an offer, that many people withdraw and also withdraw from political parties. That includes my own political party. They often no longer feel that these parties represent themselves or their interests. Look to the youth organizations, and this affects or concerns all political parties. In youth organizations, people are being isolated and are not being included. Youth organizations of MEDA are considered an opportunity to gather money and influence, but politics is not about making money, it's about working for the interests of others. Zelensky, whom I don't want to consider a holy man, I do have my critical views in that respect. Mr. President Van der Bellen rightly pointed it out that he also opened himself up to criticism with regard to his policies, but right now he is an example, he serves as an example example, and we need more of these examples. What gives me reason to be concerned is that we no longer have the young people there. And when I left, fortunately, the situation was different in my own city, but when you look at the city councils, the town councils, they tend to bring together old men or the older generation, people who have time, not necessarily the people we need. We need to have a cross-section, a representative body of society, not only old people who do politics at a late stage in their life or a very early stage in their life. We need to have a cross-section. When you look for mayors, female and male, you will find that group represented there above average. But we want to engage young people, we want to take them on board, and we also want to have the various social groups represented. But if they're scared off, because even at the local level, the struggle for power is tough. Yes, we, the parties, are being identified with the politics of the government level because people no longer focus on the different levels of politics that exist. But I think there is a way we can address this, and I think that in a way the war in Ukraine offers us an opportunity to realize what freedom means to us and what democracy stands for, what cohesion and terms like trust and setting a good example as a politician are all about. So I believe that that is another reason why we can take with us and hand over the flame of politics to others and to younger generations. Thank you. Thank you. We'll stay with this. Luke von Middler, the war reminds us of what might possibly be at stake. Will this lead to a situation where the European Union, where Europe will also become more united, do you think, and will empower itself to be able to tackle those crises that have not been tackled yet? The migration crisis of 2015-2016 is still part of this. We still feel the consequences of that. And then, of course, with an eye to the United States of the United States, Mr. Ziblatt, I met with the Canadian Prime Minister, Mr. Trudeau, yesterday and spoke about our shared neighbor with him, the so-called Freedom Convoy. Blocked parts of public life in Canada over the last few weeks and was also partially financed by the media, it turns out. These are all things that are very relevant in Canada and the United States. So I want to have a very, very optimistic perspective from you with regard to the future of democracy. But I'd like to begin with Europe and then turn to the other subjects. Thank you, Mr. President.
I will speak in English.
Yeah.
Of course, this is an incredible moment indeed for Europe. I think it is more a moment of Europe than of the West as such, because it is really experienced by citizens all across Europe as something which is happening on our continent and in the space, which also includes Russia. And the changes are remarkable, and both at the level of governments and at the level of societies, the engagement of which you have spoken, Mr. President, but also the unity of governments at EU level. We have here two flags of two states, maybe two nations and one European flag, but I think it is really a European moment. And I think it is important also to say, standpunkt Brussel, how important it has been what has happened in Berlin 2 weeks ago, more or less, with the historic speech, one we already knew already when it was given by Chancellor Scholz. So the turnaround of Germany, the geopolitical awakening almost of Germany, has in a way mobilized European unity and strength to the extent that in many of these issues of sanctions, gas dependency, and so on, Germany was on the more reluctant side of the spectrum. And so that is very, very positive and incredible. And indeed, I think under the impulse of the moment, a lot more can be done also on other topics. I'm very glad Herr Ziblatt will end with an optimistic note. So, and I I salute you for the sequence, which allows me to bring two notes of caution. The first note of caution is that if we, let's say, behave towards the outside and towards Russia as a club of democracy, we'd better make sure that it is true also internally. And we should not forget at this moment, when indeed unity is asked for, to continue looking in the mirror. And I know that issues like independence of the judiciary and the rule of law, they may seem like Nebenschauplätze at this moment of truth. But I think they are not. And I must say, and I was struck, and it's no longer at page one of the newspapers, but I was struck that on the 25th of February, a local judge in Krakow was suspended from her job for 30 days because she wanted to apply EU law. And so this is still ongoing, and I think we should not forget about it. A second note of caution, and that maybe is a bridge also to the United States, is that we as European democracies, and it's even more true for the EU institutions, we are present in the the foundations on which we are grounded. So we think of ourselves, and that is something which has been part of our discussion, from the point of view of values, above all. And we forget to think about ourselves from the point of view of power. And in a war, of course, we also have to look at ourselves. And Professor Merkel was one of the first to raise this point, and others have so too. We also have to look at ourselves from the point of power and territory, and not only from the point of view of values. And that is also to get out of the war at some point, because the risk of discourse of values is that you get into a good and evil, black and white, all or nothing logic, where we will, at this speed, we will not only have very dangerous algorithms from the wrong side, but we may even end up canceling Tolstoy and Gogol within 3 weeks. So we have to look, continue look in the mirror. So we do also need the discourse of strategy and power and negotiation, which the Americans are not forgetting, I must say. And this is the one war of the one big international crisis I have lived, let's say, in the 30 years I've been watching the news, where the Americans show more restraint than the Europeans. So that is also a very special moment in this respect. And I think that is unser Auftrag als Europäer.
And that is our mandate as Europeans.
That we can be democracies, a club of democracies, and also cohabit with other powers on the European continent or on the planet, which maybe are not democracies. That is what I wish ourselves. And I thank you for the work in this respect.
So, Mr. Ziblatt, you have the final say, the last word.
I know that the most dangerous position to be in is to be a person standing between a large group and their lunch. So I'll try to be relatively quick here. I want to tie this back to our discussion at the beginning, because I think actually the Putin invasion of Ukraine is very much connected to democracy, because what we've seen really on full display is the use of arbitrary power. And that's very much the opposite principle of the Republican principle that we laid out in the book. And so the idea that individuals have autonomy, Selbstbestimmung, capacity, I mean, this is the heart of the democratic tradition, the democratic Republican tradition, and the ability of a single leader to write an essay and to then implement that essay by invading another country. I mean, I can't even get my students to read my essays, right? So this is a pure example of unconstrained arbitrary power. And so this is very, the reason I bring this up is because I think part of what has happened in the United States, as in Europe, over the last several weeks, is a recognition of what democracy, what the value of democracy is. When we see, homes are bombed, children are fleeing for their lives, we see that democracy really means something, and it means the protection of individual rights, the protection of individual autonomy, the ability of a system to promote the capacities of individuals and groups to determine their own futures. So that's all the good news. I mean, one thing I would say, though, is that what America currently faces, from my view, is this extreme polarization that exists in the U.S. that momentarily has moved to the side, but I think it's momentary. There are deep fault lines in American society, and I think there are fault lines that are also present in European societies. And the central fault line, from my view, in the United States is that America is on the brink of becoming a multiracial democracy, a fully inclusive multiracial democracy. And so we often think of January 6th, 2021, when this assault on the Congress took place, and this was a dangerous attack on democracy. But we often forget is the day before, 24 hours, actually 12 hours before January 5th, 2021, African-American and Jewish-American senators were elected from Georgia, a Jim Crow state. And so these two moments, I think, reflect the two trends in American society. What I regard populist authoritarianism as a reaction to that first trend, to the trend of an increasingly diverse, inclusive society. And I think this is also something that European societies increasingly face as well, as they become more diverse and as they remain inclusive. And so the biggest challenge, I think, for American democracy and perhaps for other democracies as well, is how to cope with these kinds of increased diversities, which represent incredible opportunities, but at the same time, generate this backlash, generate this counter-reaction. And so, you know, in some ways, it's up to us. It's up to politicians, it's up to citizens to build the coalitions to allow the first vision of a more inclusive, multi-ethnic, multiracial democracy to triumph. And I think that, to me, is the challenge of the age.
Thank you so much. Alexander, ein paar Worte zum Schluss.
Alexander, a few concluding remarks.
Ich finde es immer wirklich interessant, wie
it's,
man,
in my eyes, always
man
interesting
über so etwas Selbstverständliches wie Demokratie
to see that when you talk about something that appears so self-evident, like democracy, that you actually start to think about the rifts that exist and the abysses that open up when it comes to understanding others, things that we just tend to somehow tackle in our everyday life without becoming too excited about it. So, in a way, this was a repetition of that experience. You don't necessarily always understand everything at the first glance, and the older you grow, the more self-evident are certain things to you, and you just address them in your way, in contrast to sociologists or other academics. I tend to be more of an economist by training in nature. I once sat on an advisory council of the finance ministry of my country.
I think we're
five or at the most 10 people on that council. We were not able to agree on a single recommendation to the finance minister. Shortly afterwards, the advisory council, of course, was dissolved, and the Republic survived, says the federal president Steinmeier.
Thank you
very much indeed. I thank you for your contribution at the beginning, and I thank you for the contributions you made to the discussion and your final assessment. I can fully subscribe to that, and when I remember correctly, 5 years ago it wasn't easy for me to bid farewell to an executive political position. I had a phantom pain for a couple of months, to be honest. If I were to be a member of some European Council to meet today, I would have the pressure of having some kind of paper at the end of this effort everyone could agree upon. Fortunately, we don't have to do that. I'm relieved that we can stand up here and leave this table, taking note of the different views and positions, knowing full well that we will continue to talk about them at some other point in time, in some other place. I thank you for your contribution, for your patience, for your commitment. Perhaps you have felt or noticed that I wanted to have at least given everyone the opportunity to speak, because some of them have traveled a long distance to come here. You've all participated, even if you commented on points that you originally had not meant to speak about. Thank you for that, too. Now, for lunch, we will have the opportunity to go in even greater depth. Thank you very much indeed.